alive, you are live.
I hope you are all very well, wherever you happen to find yourselves in the world. My name is James Henry. Gendre is on camera. He's dressed for bushwalk, but unfortunately it is a little bit rainy, and sitting to my left-hand side, your right-hand side, Stefan Winterboer.
Thank you very much, James. Good morning, good morning. Yes.
Now, the reason we are here in this camping setup, a.k.a. the Moscow Circus, is because there has been a little bit of precipitation during the course of the night. I think it's probably going to clear out. We've sent out the brave lady, Taylor. She is out in the field looking for animals in the rain. And Steph and I have taken the, well, non-chivalrous route, and we've come into the tent here. So the plan for the rain is to try and keep broadcasting regardless of the weather. I'm pretty sure that in the next 10 minutes I'll probably head out on into the bush, and then Steph will man the tent for a while. But the plan is that we will do some interesting things here. Hopefully we will not run out of content, but that's going to depend largely on you and the questions that you give us. So please do talk to us during the course of the morning, hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv, and we will answer all the questions that you want to. The radio has now exploded in my ear. We're okay now. Phew, that was close. Steph, did you stay awake because of the rain last night?
No, I didn't actually. I actually only remembered it, well, heard it raining at about 4:30-ish, about, I think. Before that, I think it was just a little bit of wind and not much else going on. And you?
I don't think I woke up to the rain. I had a fan going. This, of course, on account of the unspeakable number of mosquitoes that live in the vicinity of where we live. We're not sure why there's so many mosquitoes at the moment, but there are many. Now, many of you, I don't think, will have seen our great new collection of death that we have behind us here on the shelf. Gendre, if you might peruse the shelf of death, aka the museum. We have a wildebeest, we have a zebra. Could be a racehorse, but we think it's a zebra. Then we have a springbok. Now, many of you, we'll get into the details of them, but that is a springbok. Then over there, we have a serval, and we'll look at all of these things. That's a terrifying baboon. That's a monkey, and that's a genet. So those are some of the new things we found, and there are some more on the way, so that's quite fun. And then just over Steph's head, we've got a whole tray of insects. And we'll have a little look at those too. There will be a bit of a reflection there, and Gendre will shout at me as a result of that. Anyway, that's how it is. Now, Christine, you would like to see the baboon skull. This probably on account of the fact that you were watching yesterday morning when young Hosanna had a bit of a nasty experience. So what I'm going to do is hand this to Stefan. This is the baboon skull. I nearly got shouted at by Gendre again there. Is that right, Gendre? May I hand it to Stefan?
We'd never shout at you, James.
Gendre says he'd never shout at me. He is lying. There you are.
Thank you for this.
And the point of that, well, while Steph describes it, I'll pick something else up.
So this has to be one of the most terrifying skulls in this collection at the moment, only because of this, I don't know, all too human expression in the face up to the eyes, and then for these massive canines that they have. Just have a look at that. Those are easily as long as a lion's fangs, not quite as thick as a lion's fangs, and then unlike a lion, which are round, almost like pegs, these are sharpened. You can have a look at how they close past one another like this, sharpening that blade-like edge.
And I think the reason that they are so much sharper, perhaps, is that a baboon is not necessarily a bone eater. They will eat meat. But those canines are ostensibly for defense.
Yeah, exactly. Fighting for mates.
They're not used for kill, so they're not biting bones and things.
It's a display.
Sharper. Now, this is a serval skull. This is not the skull of a young leopard. But it's probably not too much smaller than young Hosanna's skull. His might be slightly bigger. Now, let me just put this next to the baboon that Steph is holding. And that is roughly the size differential between the skulls of the two animals that were in conflict yesterday. Now, if you did miss it, what happened was that a baboon troop came across the royals as they were feeding on an impala. The baboons gave chase, the leopards ran away, and the big male baboon of the troop actually had contact with Hosanna. and we think he caught him on the ground. We think the little leopard probably swatted the baboon and shot up a tree. The baboon went straight up after him, but because the little leopard is a little bit lighter, he managed to perch on the very top of the tree, and using his height advantage, he swatted down at the baboon, who kept trying to grab him and pull him out of the tree. And you can see, if he'd got hold of him, well, it wouldn't really have been very pretty at all. Now, on that rather somber and, scary note, let's head across to Taylor McCurdy and find out how the rain is treating her.
The rain is not so bad in the morning. It's actually quite nice and refreshing and cooling, and it's putting a lovely layer of sort of mist on the ground, and hopefully the grass will absorb that all up and continue growing. Well, good morning. My name is Taylor, and on camera I've got Brian and, of course, the thumb. There it is. Is it suit and tie again?
It is suit and tie.
Suit and tie, very elegant, very smart as always. I always feel very underdressed when I'm around the thumb, especially in the morning. Now, we are on the search for some lions. That's what we're hoping to see this morning. And we did see a few footprints, a few little tracks. They seem to be going west. So we're going to hopefully try and pick up on the rest of them. I'm not sure if the Nkuhumas were found yesterday afternoon. I wonder, maybe you know, maybe you heard something that I didn't hear. The birds didn't perhaps whisper in my ear this morning. But if you do perhaps know or remember if anything was said about the Nkuhumas, I'd love to hear from you. So you can either hashtag Safari Live with that information, or you can email it to questions@wildearth.tv. I very much like to hear from you on this chilly morning. Although I don't think it's too chilly. Like I said, I think it's actually quite fresh. It's nice. It's better than the sweltering heat when the sweat is dripping down your forehead. That's not ever pleasant. So this is quite nice. Oh, thank you, Lucy. Lucy said that there were cubs playing at the dam cam this morning. Thank you very much, lionesses and cubs, of course. Thank you so much, Lucy, for that wonderful information. Well, that gives me something to go on, and it reminded me of what I should do. So at the moment, I'm making my way to Mbubu Road. So I'm heading to Bubbles Hook Cut Line, and then I'm going to go along Mbubu Road to get to behind the lodge, and hopefully we'll find them there, perhaps just lurking under a gwarri tree or in a drainage line, just trying to avoid this little spit. But it's not too bad. Now I'm trying to work out which way the clouds are coming, if they're coming, and which way they're going, to figure out this little nimbus stratus cloud that we have found ourselves underneath. It's spitting a little bit. Also, seeing as though it is spitting quite a bit, you may see a bit of a cloth come across the screen. That's just Brian just wiping it, keeping it nice and clean, so don't be alarmed, you haven't lost us. There it is again, just to show you, just to keep it squeaky clean. Right, so we're looking carefully, and hopefully those lions haven't gone too far from the camera. I am waiting for the other guests to leave the lodge before I go venturing around there. Ah, but we've found some buffaloes. Hello, buffalo. Just gonna go a little bit further forward. It seems like a nice herd. Let's have a look at this cow here. No, don't walk away from us. We like you. There she is. Good morning. Have you perhaps lost a member to the lions today at all? No? Doesn't seem like it. I'm working on learning how to communicate with the animals. It's not going too well so far. Brian and I were discussing if we could have one superpower, it would either be to speak to animals or to speak to the plants and the vegetation. I like the idea, Brian, though, of speaking to the vegetation. Brian made a very good point. Imagine having a conversation with a 500-year-old tree. Wouldn't that be interesting? The wealth of knowledge that would come from that tree would be amazing. And the horror stories, I'm sure, too. We've just stumbled across. It's just a very small breeding herd. It doesn't seem to be particularly big. I can't hear very much communication going on amongst them, which we normally hear when we've got those big herds of a few hundred coming through. There's probably about maybe 15 to 20 buffalo here, which is great. And I'm just listening because I think I can hear the hornbills again. It sounds like the southern ground hornbills are calling in the distance, which is quite exciting as well. You know that they're one of my favorite birds, and I absolutely love to spend time with them. So perhaps that could be on the cards for this morning as well. Now, these buffalo have come from sort of the DRC where we live. and come out of the drainage line. And I presume that would have been the lion's next move, because they've come from the east and now they're maybe moving west, possibly trying to flush out some buffalo. And that's, of course, one of their favorite hunting grounds around Hyena Road, around Central, around all those drainage lines. So that's sort of where we're going to head around to next and keep checking there. But you can see that, hey, that buffalo is actually browsing. It's quite surprising that they're still eating leaves, even though there's plenty of grass to go around, just nibbling on a few little shrubs. We normally only see this behavior in the winter months when they get quite desperate, but I suppose if there's an opportunity, they're not going to say no. Come here, let me catch you. Oh no. Sorry, I tried to catch an insect. Oh, I've got one. I'm going to try and catch it. Please stay there, don't fly, just be nice. She wants to see an antlion. I want to show you an antlion. You're going to have to be very quick, Ryan, because I suspect that it's going to fly. No, don't panic. There we go, settle down and then you can fly away. So this is and as quick as we saw it, it is now gone. No, you got a quick look. It's about to try and fly and land on Brian's head. Now that was an antlion, and I'm sure you've possibly seen the little insects before. If not, we'll try and find one that perhaps hasn't been disturbed by the rain. But often when you walk outside, and maybe you'll remember this as a child, you walk outside and you see these little conical pits going down into the ground. I hope you know what I'm talking about. And normally it's a strange looking insect that lives at the bottom, and it's basically an ant trap, as the name suggests, ant lion. Now that was the adult ant lion that I had looked. So it had pupated and it had turned into a beautiful, it looks almost like a very flimsy dragonfly if I had to describe it. But there's a few differences between them though. Obviously, I don't know if you noticed, when I had it in my hand, it sat nice and quietly with its wings closed to its body, unlike a dragonfly, which will often open its wings when it is perched, as well as their antennae being slightly different. On the antlion, they are clubbed, whereas they are not clubbed on the dragonfly. Oh, this herd of buffalo seems to be slightly bigger than what I expected. Hello everyone, we've now seemed to have found the bulk of the herd. It's okay everyone. Now, we're looking at these buffalo and they're giving us a bit of a stare, though I'm not worried because I'm in the vehicle. That is the very typical buffalo death look that we get. Now, they seem fairly relaxed. They're not particularly bothered. This is quite normal. And I know that Kathy was wondering this morning, are the animals' behaviors altered by the rain? Now, Kathy, I think that would depend on the amount of rain that we've got and sort of the severity of it. At the moment, it's just a lovely little drizzle, so it's not bothering them at all. I mean, there's barely any water on their coat. You can see they're just looking a little bit damp. But if it gets to torrential rain, what that does is, like the same thing for us, is that it often muffles sound having that heavy rain. And when we get heavy rain, often we have the lightning and the thunder to go with it. So it could indeed prevent them from hearing as well. And also it's very unpleasant. So they should be hiding sort of in the thicket. They wouldn't be standing out in the open during torrential rain. So they'd be a little bit more secretive, but only just trying to find some shelter. But you can see they're obviously enjoying my conversation this morning. Well, the two on the right, they are very focused on me, but it looks like it's lifting up. I'm actually quite excited. It's actually brightened up quite a bit this morning already. Just in the last 5 minutes, the clouds seem to be lifting. There's just the occasional little nimbostratus cloud, which is bringing the odd drizzle, but no big cumulonimbus clouds bringing thunderstorms, I'm afraid. We can only be so hopeful to encounter a big thunderstorm like we've had a few weeks ago. But the bush is looking beautiful, don't you think? Look at all that greenery as that buffalo disappears down into the distance. And off they go. They've changed their minds now. Now they crossed the road coming from the east and now they went west. And now look at them. Now they're all coming back again. Perhaps they heard something. Perhaps they smelled something that I can't smell. It's interesting. That one's got all the oxpeckers, and you can see the oxpeckers aren't feeding. Ooh, something startled them. What's wrong? Now, I don't think it's us, because we've been sitting here very quietly. We haven't even really been moving the vehicle around too much. Perhaps it is just a scent that's come through. Half the herd doesn't seem to be reacting. I think sometimes buffalo can be a bit like sheep. If one does one thing, then they tend to follow and do exactly the same thing. There we go. See, they're sniffing the ground. Now, when this buffalo move, I'm going to go and try and have a look to see what they're smelling. You can see that they're all quite interested. Well, not that one, just one. So I'm not going to try and guess as to what it was. Perhaps something has urinated there. But we'll go and have a look. Maybe something's walked there. Remember, the different animals have got various scent glands. Obviously, with the cats, we often see them urine spraying. They've got little glands in their cheeks when they often rub their faces up against the branches. And of course, some of the antelope species have pedal glands, which are scent glands in between the hooves. And when they walk, they're actually depositing a little secretion down onto the ground as well. But let's go a little bit forward. I'm going to go, even though I know the buffalo are moving towards us, I would like to have a look and see what caught their attention. Check behind me that there isn't any lions sneaking up that I've completely missed. Let's try and have a look. Now, I'm just trying to have a look over here. It's quite difficult. I don't think it was particularly anything. I think it was actually just another buffalo that had perhaps walked back across. Because the only thing I can see on the ground is very old buffalo dung, which you can maybe see. It might be a bit closer. There it is. There are lots of buffalo footprints, but I don't see any scrapings of any sort. So I'm uncertain as to what it was. Well, that's quite interesting. It doesn't seem like too much, but they've all settled down now. No one else is running. Maybe it was just a nervous Nancy that... Right. Ooh. Okay, thanks so much, Lucy. Lucy, you've been fantastic this morning with the updates on the lions. So I'm going to keep moving away from these buffalo now. Lucy's just mentioned that it seemed as though those lions went down Twin Dams Road. So they were sneaky. They went back even further east, which means I'm behind them, and we're going to have to keep moving on from these buffalo. But as I carry on and try and get us around quite quickly and catch up with the movements of the lions, let's go back to James in the tent.
Well, it seems that the weather is not looking too bad, so I'll probably head out shortly and we'll leave Steph manning the fort here. But in the meantime, Taylor yesterday, during our rehearsal, found this leaf full of little caterpillar eggs. Now, I'll hand the caterpillar over to Steph while I focus on the microphone, the microscope, and that's called a hospital pass, everybody, because I don't know what that thing's called. And so we'll just test Steph.
It's called a caterpillar.
It's called a caterpillar, says Steph. That's brilliant. Excellent stuff. Now, let me try and focus in on these things. Turn up a bit of light here. Light is on full. Hang on, we need a black background, which we can achieve with great skill. Can't we, Jean-André?
Very ingenious.
Yes, very ingenious. Thank you, Rebecca. This comment from the peanut gallery. Rebecca is directing this morning, everybody. She's being sarcastic, which of course we know is only I'm allowed to do. Why can I not see this thing? Oh, for goodness sakes, really? Okay, let's see what that looks like. Sorry about this, everyone. Not showing great competence. Oh, there we go. Those, everybody, are the caterpillar eggs. They look like little golden pine cones. Isn't that cool? And we're pretty sure that they are the caterpillar eggs from the caterpillar that Steph has got in his paw, and we'll put that under the microscope too and show you the amazing colours. And it's... we think that they're the same because they were found on the same bush. So they're not necessarily the same, but they could well be. And the bush is a red bush willow, a Cumbritum apiculatum, which of course is the most common tree that we get out here, and the tree from which the vegetation type here derives its name. Okay, Jean-André, let's have a look here. Very nice. Good. There you are, everyone. There is the caterpillar. Isn't he amazing? Look at his little hairs, perfectly aligned, beautiful. Greens and blacks and whites and golds and oranges. I suppose, Steph, what you might describe as aposomatic coloration.
Yeah, it looks quite distasteful. I mean, I don't want to put that in my mouth. I suppose if I was a bird, I would.
Yes. It looks almost like a bird dropping. And many, many caterpillars and things out here, everybody, are disguised as bird droppings. And that's obviously because birds don't like to eat their own droppings very often. And so that's why their caterpillar disguises itself as a bird dropping. Anyway, that will pupate into some form of moth or butterfly. I'm not sure which. We'll find out as time goes on. Now, a little bit like a child who has a silkworm selection, we're going to keep these here and see if we can't make them hatch. We'll feed them Cambrium leaves. That's Taylor's job when she's not on drive. She has to feed our collection of insects. Good. Very nice. Now, just to keep you posted, we are, of course, as live as Taylor is, out in the bush. Hashtags for our live questions at wilder.tv if you want to ask us any questions here in the tent. Like I say, short of the great Moscow circus, which I don't see swinging from the roof here, keeping things entertaining in here is going to be very much up to you as well as it is up to us. Jean-André, how are your arms feeling? He's nodding, so he seems to be okay. All right, now, let us have a look at the national animal. Stefan can tell you about the national animal there.
Quite often we get questions about the difference between springbuck and impala, and I thought that this was just a nice skull to show everybody that difference. I know there are two vastly different. This is our most common antelope, the impala. And this is the national animal, the springbuck. Now, I think that in terms of what is comparative from an environmental scale, I think the impala would probably be likened to a blessed buck, I would imagine. Mm. Whereas the springbuck is probably closer to a bush buck in terms of size. Mm. Maybe a little bit smaller. It's definitely a little bit smaller. Yeah. Sort of between a great Dacre and a bush buck, I would imagine.
Yeah.
That it would be. But what they do share a common trait in, they're both horns. In other words, the horns grow from a bed, and you can see there that there's a bony core to this particular horn. And the horn covering is a sheath. They also got these ridges on them. And the ridges are used when they're jousting with one another as pressure ridges to stop the horns from sliding past one another and inflicting too much injury. So you can see that they lock against one another, and only with extreme effort or with a slight twist of the horn can they disengage, at which point a stabbing motion is aimed at the neck or the flanks of the opponent. And you can see there, although that's not sharp, with a little bit of weight behind it, it's not meant to do damage. They're meant to wrestle against one another. But if needs be, and if the competitors are roughly equal in power and size, then these horns can inflict terrible damage. And we see quite a lot of impala in the rut, especially the dominant impala, with holes in their necks and underneath their arms, and in some cases on their rumps, on their backs.
Sometimes missing an eye, even.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, yeah.
Betty Sleep, you wanted to know how these artifacts are preserved. Well, they're preserved in two different ways. You said bleached, scrubbed, or cured. Well, this one has been bleached by a professional. This one has been collected probably from a kill site that Karula made. So that one was professionally done. Of course, springbok do not occur in the Kruger National Park region. They only occur up in the desert regions and highveld regions of South Africa. They're much better adapted to living in dry conditions. And they are gazelles, which are slightly different ungulates than from the antelope. I'm not entirely sure what the biological difference is, but they are slightly different. And we would have seen the only gazelles we've seen on Safari Live have been the ones, of course, we saw in the Mara. Didn't we, Jean-André? Yes, we did. He's smiling now at the memory of sharing a room with me for 10 days.
Oh, I've just got a question in from Chai Connie, who wants to know relative intelligence of these animals. And what I want to do for you, Chai, is this is a vervet monkey, a relatively intelligent being. Have a look at inside. This is where the spine joins the back of the head or the bottom of the skull, and where the extension of the brain goes. And you can see inside there is the brain
cavity,
yes. Now, I would imagine that having a look at that and having a look at this one, Although the aperture is bigger, this one would be bigger because it's a slightly bigger animal. The brain volumes are almost identical. Now, these antelope, they do fight to their heads, and so I would expect there to be a thickening of bone on the front of the skull. But I'm just going to use, obviously I have a better view of this than you do, but I'm just going to use my and James's comparison, and I would say that the skull of the vervet monkey, which is less than half the weight of a springbuck, is much bigger.
So that's the key, isn't it?
That's the
ratio.
Key. The ratio, yeah. Brain weight to body mass, and the ratio that is, the closer it is to ours, the more intelligent the animals are. And this would obviously have a bigger brain weight to body mass ratio than this. Doesn't mean that these are completely, they're not imbeciles, they're not imbecilic, but they're a lot more, they're a lot more instinct driven than what these creatures are, at least.
James Richard, you're interested in the social structure of the springbok and whether it's the same as impala. It's not dissimilar, but the males don't tend to form bachelor groups. I don't think too much. They set up little territories, and when the females wander through, they try and keep them in that area and cover them, and then they'll kind of be left to go off. I think that's probably a bit more wildebeest-like than it is impala-like. So they don't form those bachelor herds, but the other thing that they do is breed twice a year, quite often, if conditions are, you know, allow for it. So they have a much shorter gestation period. I think it's about 5 months or so. So that's what they do. It's now starting to rain again, unfortunately. So that's the case there, James Richard. And I think we'll have another little discussion on intelligence when you come back from Taylor, who is now... she's actually got an animal to show you.
We have found a very damp virtual starling. It's also very chatty. I'm just going to let you listen to it for just a moment. And now, of course, it's going to stop and eat. When it calls again, I'll sit quietly. But I think it's found a few termites. You hear it? You might also hear the pitter-patter of the rain. But this is one happy starling. Doesn't seem to mind the rain too much. Now, the rain has all of a sudden got a little bit heavier. As you can see. Very chatty this morning, quite happy. Normally you see them all miserable and fluffed up, trying to hide out of the weather. But I suppose it's been drizzling for a little bit. The ground is nice and soft, which makes it very easy to peck and find little insects, perhaps little ants, or again, like I said, the termites. Now, another bird that I can hear in the distance, which I was asking James about a few days ago, is the Birchall's cuckoo, or the rain bird. And it's got the most beautiful call. I suspect it may be a little bit far, but let's see if we can try and hear it. Now it's stopped calling. I'm just going to see if it's going to start again. No, now they're very quiet. Now, I don't know if some of you know what a Birchall's cuckoo is. It's a beautiful bird, and I'm actually going to try and find a photo for you. Let's get my book out, which has encountered lots and lots of rain before, so it's not scared. Where are you, cuckoo? No, you must be over here. There we go. Almost there. Almost. Right. If you have a look at the top over here, you can see where have you gone? There you are. The Birchall's cuckoo. You see that beautiful bird? Isn't it amazing? Now, it's quite large, surprisingly. They're probably just longer than the length of a ruler, maybe 10 centimeters more or so. And they make the most beautiful call. And they are associated with the rain. They often are called the rain birds. And normally, and I can only say for the Eastern Cape, because they were very accurate down on the southeast coast of South Africa, is they would always call just before the rains began, and then of course while it was raining they were also calling. They were quite beautiful. And we had some massive floods in 2012, and I'll never forget that the morning before the rain descended on us, I counted 22 Birchall starlings that morning. Well, that afternoon it thundered and lightninged and poured with rain that we had to evacuate guests. Isn't that incredible? Not incredible, but nature is amazing as how quickly it could bring rain that the next day Everybody had to leave, especially the lodges down on the river, because the rivers, a lot of bank dam walls burst, and of course then increased the flow of water, and we almost lost one of the lodges. We lost a few boats. They capsized and went floating down the river. Now we're carrying along, and what I'm hoping to do is try and pick up on these lions. Ooh, I've just got a little bit of water that's gone down my back and into my pants. Oh, that feels delicious. Isn't that amazing, Brian? Did you get some?
Yeah, my bum's wet.
Brian says his bum's wet already. I think he won that race. Something else I'd like to do as well is follow up on the lions. I don't know if you remember a few mornings ago before Rusty had to be rushed to the emergency room, we found a magpie shrike nest, and I definitely like to try and follow up on that as well. But we're going to first try and find these lions. Now, I had a little look on the open area, I didn't see anything on the lions. Now we're just driving on the opposite bank of from where Twin Dams Road is, just to see if they perhaps haven't come down into this drainage and then crossed over. We're just going to take it easy through here. It's going to make tracking very, very difficult for us this morning, which is not good, as the ground is very wet, and if the animals have walked, their tracks are now going to be covered with lots of tiny raindrops. Let's have a look here. Oh, I can see the Birchall's Kukul. Can you believe it? Can you see it in the tree there, Brian? Oh, no, wait, we're going to try and roll. We have to go stealth mode. That's exciting. That's the first one I've seen. It's just flown back in here. Can you still see it? There it hops. Let's see if we can get a better shot. Now, it's just hopping in the tops of the trees. There it is. Can you see the movement? So you can also see the movement of the aerial, but hopefully it will stop. Now, in there is that Birchall's Kukul that I was just showing you a picture of. Now, I'm going to just sit quietly because I think it got slightly startled by the vehicle, but perhaps it'll jump down on some lower branches. Let me see if I can chuff it out. I don't think it'll work with a Kukul, though, but we can always try. Well, the rain is coming down quite heavily now. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to move forward because I want to try and get a little bit of shelter out of this rain, and hopefully this Kukul doesn't fly off. I'm going to try to keep my eyes on it. Don't fly, we want to see you. Don't fly, hang on. Let's see if I can find it. There it goes. Do you see it fly? Now, we're just looking at... there it is. Well, Brian, fantastic work from you. There we go. Have a quick look, because I don't think it's going to hang around for too long. So, like I said, the Birchall's Kukul, and it's making an interesting sound. It's not happy about something. Perhaps it's complaining about the rain, which I'm about to start doing. Oh, look at everything getting wet. That's nice. I'm just covering my books. I forgot about them. I neglected them. So if you see the camera moving around, that was me just trying to cover all the very important items. Now, Chris, you were wondering how many different species of kukuls there are in this area. I've only ever seen the Birchall's, but perhaps there's a few others that could occur. Should we have a little look? I'm going to quickly try and open my book again without getting it too wet, because it does love the rain, but I don't want all my pages to get stuck together. So we will quickly try and find out. Birchall's is the most common around South Africa. Possibly, if you're very lucky, maybe if you go along the far east, you could maybe see a black kukul, but I think you'd be extremely lucky. So, Chris, I'm just going to go and say that I think for us, it's just the Birchall's kukul. There's all different ones all over Africa and Zambia. We had the Senegal kukul. Oh, there it still is. Hang on, it's hopping out again. Perhaps we may get one last look at this kukul. Remember, if you do see a cloth coming across the screen, it is Brian. He's just wiping it to get rid of the drops. Now, these birds are quite incredible. I'm sorry, I got a bit sidetracked there. And they are incredible hunters too. So you often see them feeding on the ground and sort of pecking through the leaves like chickens, but not really after the smaller insects. They love big termites. I've even seen them eating big lizards and all sorts of other things. Even little mouse before, I've seen that. So they are ferocious predators. And everybody obviously takes an opportunity. Listen. I'm going to sit quietly. There's a duet. I hope you all heard that. Really beautiful. Isn't that beautiful, listening to them call like that? Now, that is one of the most amazing sounds in the bush. So I hope you got an opportunity to hear that. It was a duet. Now, there's not much difference between the males and females, I'm afraid. Now, isn't this beautiful? Now, this really reminds me of home. This is what I know. This is what we used to hear every single day growing up in the gardens in the Eastern Cape of South Africa. So I'm getting all sorts of memories popping into my head of my childhood. I hope you're enjoying this as much as I am. Now, Dispatch Griffin, you're wondering if this is perhaps the start of rainy season or if it's just a bit of off-chance rain. We're a little bit uncertain at the moment as to what's really going on. And now, we normally get big thunderstorms at this time of the year. We haven't really had any of those. It seems to just be the clouds coming over and we have a slight drizzle. I don't think it's going to rain for too much. There it disappears. Just, I think it's gone a little bit down. There it goes. Off it flies. Oh, it's actually going to perch itself a little bit better on that dead dog tree over there. Can you see it just sitting on that branch? There it is. That's actually a very nice view of it. So, Dispatch Griffin, I'm reluctant to say that this is the start of the rainy season. I'll believe it when we get a big downpour, a really big downpour of 50 mils of rain or so with thunder and lightning, and then perhaps that will signal the start. I think it's still a little bit early. And off it goes. How wonderful was that? Thank you, Mr. Birchall's Kukul, or Mrs. Birchall's Kukul. Now, we're going to carry on in the search for the Nkuhumas, and while we do that, let's go see how the men in the tent are doing.
Hello everybody, welcome back to the tent. Now, things are getting a little inclement outside, so Taylor's going to have to come home. You won't have to stare, just Steph and I. You'll have the beauteous Taylor arriving fairly soon, I think. Now, we had a question, I think it was from Betty. That's a signal to the final control to tell me again. Oh. Name? Anyway, I think it was Betty. Sorry, Betty, if it was you, mostly if it wasn't you, wanted to see different wood grains under the microscope. This piece here is called a zebra wood, and you can see that Stefan, with his collection of terrifying knives, has just managed to clean us a nice edge there. So what we'll do is have a look at it under the microscope. There we are. You can see it is very black. That is the zebra part of it. And indeed, David, it is very white. Jeffrey, sorry, from Texas, not Betty at all, wanted to know about the different grains of wood. So that's a zebra wood. That's actually a false kind of impression of the color and brought on by the microscope. But a zebra wood inside is actually more... Sorry, I've got a little bit confused here. Inside it, it's a kind of creamy color. Inside it's black, and then outside you get this kind of creamy color, and that's why it's called a zebra wood. Right, thank you very much.
The smell of there where I cut that on.
Yes. This, everybody, is the sneeze wood, Pterozygum obliquum. I remember that because I learned it on a walk with Steph and Scott once. Now look at the beautiful grain of wood there. And to Steph, this smells like, Steph?
Cheese curls. A type of a crisp flavouring here that's very, I suppose cheesy would be a good word, but it's that artificial cheese flavouring, that yellow dust that you find on some crisps around. That's, I don't know what else that
those things that say. You really shouldn't be giving your kids or eating yourself, but on the back end of a really hungry day, you just can't resist those sorts of things. Now let's have a look at the grain. There it is. You can see the colour is very different, but I mean the grain is not particularly different, I suppose. Both quite dense, but the zebra wood probably the densest. Mm. But interestingly, those stripes, for those of you who are interested, are caused by the venation in the tree. So those are the veins. They were the veins, the xylem and phloem that carried water to the leaves and then carbohydrates from the leaves down to the bottom of the plant. It was through those very narrow capillary tubes there, xylem and phloem they're called. And that's when they died, of course, they became this dead wood. And that's what created the wood of this Pterozygum obliquum. Very nice. Now, Let us put that back and see what else we can show you.
I actually wouldn't mind.
Yes?
I wouldn't mind trying to light this at some point.
Light it?
Yeah, it's apparently full of oil that comes out and under pressure. Let's see. So there used to be a type of bearing they made from this wood that it was basically a self-oiling bearing or self-lubricating bearing. For the life of me, I cannot remember what this bearing is called. It's at the tip of my tongue. It'll come to me when, of course, my mind is blank, which happens quite often, and then I'll tell you. But what should happen is the more we rub it, the shinier this piece of wood should get. And it's heat that brings out the oils in this wood. And I'm expecting to take my thumb away from this and to have it be quite shiny. Is that shiny, David? More shiny than it was? James?
It's positively glistening.
So that's that oil coming out there.
Why don't we try and set it alight?
So now, Chris, you've asked what is the oldest tree in this area. Chris, so in this local area, I would imagine that the oldest tree would either be a leadwood. I would imagine the oldest tree here would be one of the massive leadwoods that we have on Juma. The oldest tree in this area, in where we are now, this local area, is a baobab tree that's located just outside Hoedspruit, and that is about 1,600 and something years old. The oldest tree in South Africa is an olive, a wild olive that is growing in the Waterberg, and they've aged that just over 3,000 years old, 3,500 years old.
That is amazing.
And the oldest tree in the world is also an olive, situated in Jerusalem at about 6,000 years old.
3,000 and 6,000.
Yeah.
And, well, yes, I was going to say something intemperate there, but I'm not going to say it anymore. So 6,000 years old, 3,000 years old, 1,600 years old. Ask Steph how on earth he knows that the tree in the Waterberg is the oldest tree in South Africa. Stefan, how do you know that?
A very good friend of mine was shown this tree by a botanist that was walking around with Eugene Marais. And Eugene Marais was a very famous South African naturalist and botanist. He used to walk around in an area called the Waterberg, which is close to Pretoria, and a local friend of his showed him this tree, which was then taken to the University of Pretoria and carbon dated, and so they have a fairly accurate record. I'm sure there are older trees in South Africa, but for now, there's just this one known example. I can get the exact years.
Just think about that for a second. I mean, 3,000 years ago was the year plus minus, well, not exact, not plus minus at all. So it was 1020 BC, wasn't it? No, it wasn't. 2020, hang on 1 second, everybody, less 1,000 would make it the, yes, 1,004 BC.
Yep.
Is that right?
No, it's not, but it's somewhere around there.
It's brief.
What James is trying to do is take 2016
and mine. Let's just go to 1,000 BC plus minus and decide what the place must have looked like. 3,000 years ago, knocking about the Waterberg, there were probably the beginnings of the Bantu migration coming down the side of, or eastern and side of Africa, and the, I'll draw you a map of this actually, and down the plateau. They're just coming down into this area, very early sort of migrations maybe, but there would definitely have been sand people around here,
yep.
Stone Age people around, very little in the way of iron working or copper working, of course, out in this area.
It was a little bit.
Then there was a little bit, hey?
Yeah, yeah.
So can you imagine the stories that olive tree must have to tell? And more importantly, can you imagine the stories that 6,000-year-old one in Jerusalem have got to tell? Well, the stories that they have to tell, of course, are different from the stories that the zebra had to tell. I don't think that the zebra made it to 6,000 years old. Do you, Steph?
No.
Anyway, this is a bleached zebra skull. This was not killed by one of the animals here. I'm not sure where it was harvested, but we got it from a professional taxidermist. And I just think it's really quite impressive, the size. So I'll put it next to my head. Now, we were talking about relative intelligence a little bit earlier. If you look at the brain case of this zebra, it's probably, I mean, what would you say you could push in there? I'd say you could probably get a fairly substantial avocado pear, roughly that shape and size. And compared with the mass of the zebra, of course, that is very, very small indeed. And compared with your brain, compared with your mass, well, the zebra is just not going to come up to you on calculus, for example. They're not good at calculus, zebra. But what I think is also interesting, Steph was talking a lot yesterday about the muscle attachments. And we were talking about the jaws of the zebra. And when you mentioned it, I thought, well, I went to the skull straight away. And I thought to myself, I don't think those are as big as I expected them to be. And I wondered, and I don't know what you think, just to clear up what we're talking about here, the muscles attach over there, and actually probably to round about where my finger is. And they drive this very substantial bottom jaw, which obviously has to chew a huge amount of grass during the course of the zebra's life, if it lives to the age that this one did. I don't know how old this one was, but I'm going to say probably about 12 years or so. So those muscles attach to an extremely solid bottom jaw, which is actually at least as solid as a buffalo's.
At least.
And I think that's quite interesting. Why do you think a zebra should have such a heavy jaw in comparison with the buffalo's?
I would either imagine that it's... My initial thought goes straight to a bit of a defense like rhino that have a skull capable of taking a knock. Because a zebra, when they fight with one another, kick each other. And I think that having a stronger jaw, you might find, is working for some... You don't have the danger of breaking a jaw, which, of course, is the only way that you get to feed yourself. So that's... If I were to just, I don't know, that would probably be my exam question or my exam answer.
The other thing, of course, is that both a rhino and a zebra have got a completely different feeding strategy from something like a buffalo. And maybe the fact that they don't ruminate. And I also don't think, I've never seen a zebra biting with that round motion. They don't chew like a zebra, like a buffalo does. That's how a buffalo will chew its food. And it crushes the grass across the molars like that. These things tend to just kind of, a bit like us almost, chew like us and then swallow, and maybe that's got something to do with it. But when you say that it's quite similar to a rhino's, that is quite interesting. This one was in dire need of some orthodontic treatment at one stage. Anyway, on the subject of brain sizes and brain design, for a long time, remember, we on Safari Live here talk a huge amount about animal emotions and the seat of the emotions, or the temperance of emotions and urges and that sort of instinctual response, is apparently supposed to be controlled, I think, by the frontal cortex, if I'm not mistaken, which is just in the front of your brain. And recent research shows that quite different from what we thought for a long time, in other words, that humans had a much more well-developed frontal cortex, animals actually have proportionately the same size frontal cortex as we do. And so when we start talking about animal emotions and we start talking and anthropomorphizing our emotions onto animals, we're probably not actually being that wishful. They probably do feel and react to emotions for very good biological reasons in much the same way that we do. And I always think that's quite nice because, as I've been banging on with lately, we all know, or anybody who's ever owned a cat or a dog knows, that an animal is not a completely sort of mindless and emotionless automaton. And I think that's quite a nice science to back that up. Right, shall we find something else?
I think we should.
Yes. What I would like to do, actually, is get a drop of water from outside on one of these trees and look at it under the microscope. David, come out here. Let us check the weather. It's actually looking pretty good. Maybe we'll head out after all. Poor old Taylor will come back. She'll be freezing cold, and then we'll send her back out again. Now, this leaf of the silver cluster leaf... How's that, David?
Good.
...is holding the water because it's got hairs on it. And it's those hairs, of course, that give the silver cluster leaf its name. Silver. Right. Shall we have a look at it under the microscope, David? Now. Oh, it's quite pretty. There we are, everybody. Those are the drops of water on the silver cluster leaf. Isn't that pretty? The different sizes. Caught up in the hairs, the silver hairs, and you can see those silver hairs very clearly now. That is gorgeous, David. It's gorgeous.
Beautiful.
And there a caterpillar has had a bite. Very nice. Good. Okay, so that is the silver cluster leaf. Now, let's see what else we have here. Okay. And while we find the next thing to talk about, let's head to Taylor for an update on whether she is in fact coming home or not.
We're finally on Twin Dams Road. Now we're going to have a look to see where these lions popped out. I haven't seen any more tracks, I'm afraid, so I'm just avoiding the aerial. If you see me and it looks like I'm driving like I've had a few too many, please don't be alarmed. We often have to do this. That and because of the tortoises, I think we're going to see, as well as all the insects crossing the road, they all sort of drive and swerve. We never seem to really go in a straight line. Now, going through a little... Yeah, we've got, we had some impala, but my squeaky brakes unfortunately gave them a bit of a fright and they've darted off into the thicket. That's all right. Hopefully we're going to come around the corner and there's going to be a few damp cats, which I'd prefer to see. Just having a very quick look. I don't want to miss any tracks because it would be really disappointing if I had to turn around and go back the way I've just come from. I'm just going to take it very easy over here. The ground's quite hard, as on, like I said, with the droplets falling in the track, it makes it just that much more difficult for us to try and find them. But it doesn't seem like they've come here. Well, they haven't walked on the road, but they could have walked somewhere else. Right, have a little look. Lots of fresh buffalo tracks though, and buffalo dung. Which, that's a good sign for us. So it seems as though it's difficult to see. It was just before the rain, it looks like, that there were quite a few. If you see some buffalo dung on the road just over there. Now, you can see that fresh little patty over there, and there's lots of tracks that are going around as well. Now, if this is the direction that the Nkuhumas were coming, that's great. That's good news for us. Perhaps maybe they heard something. So that's what we're going to keep looking out for. Quite exciting. I like it. When we find... No, not yet. There's a trick to turning jigger on. I'm still learning. Now, ideally, I would have preferred to have seen some lion tracks going over the buffalo footprints and the buffalo dung. But alas, we haven't. But that's okay. Still just lots and lots of buffalo. Goodness, you couldn't drive 10 meters over the last few days without bumping into an elephant. And they seem to have disappeared. Let's have a quick look here. If the rain holds off, it got quite heavy earlier and we were contemplating coming back, but it seems to have settled down quite nicely, then we will perhaps go back for the magpie strike nest. But for now, while we're unsure of what we're going to do, we don't want to get this wonderful equipment too wet. So we were just going to try and have a look for the lions for the moment. Okay, can't see anything here. I'm just passing Ingwe Alley now. Oh, the ground is sort of nice and soft. Maybe they even went back to that old kill, but I can't imagine that there was anything left on that buffalo carcass from yesterday morning. But if we don't find them here, then perhaps we'll have to go in and have a look. Ah, we've got vultures. Well spotted, Brian. Oh, quickie breaks. Just let everyone know we're here. You've got a few white-backed vultures perched up nicely in what used to be a knob thorn. Now again, possibly the lions are around. We're going to have a little look, or perhaps they've just decided to roost here for the evening. We're uncertain. It's sort of the similar thing that we saw yesterday morning when it was a bit miserable and they just sort of rested up in the few trees waiting for the clouds to lift. Oh, have a look at the one that's got its wings open. Oh, it did have its wings open. Let's see if it does it again. There it is. standing like that. I think everybody's a little bit on the wet side this morning, and perhaps opening these wings like that is allowing the small breeze, the gentle breeze that we've got to dry the inside of its feathers. Now, if you look at the vultures, I don't know if you can see around their body, they're quite fluffy. And they've got a lovely layer of down feathers, and that they need because they fly up to very, very high altitudes. Oh, that wasn't very nice. Don't open your wings too far. That's in my space. It's sort of like when you eat around the table, have dinner around the table with your family, and somebody bumps you with their elbows, you know, you give them a jab back. But as I was saying, is that they need those lovely fluffy feathers so that they can keep warm when they fly a few thousand feet up into the air. But that's quite funny to see the three of them. It's like Tweedledee, Tweedledum, and their cousin Jack, or whoever it is that's visiting for the weekend. They don't look too happy though this morning. And as we're sitting here looking, I'm also scanning around, listening, hopefully trying to hear a contact call or something like that, but it doesn't seem as though we're going to be too lucky. There's another one with... Now, we've often been seeing the larger birds, so from the big eagles to the southern ground hornbills to the vultures roosting up or even just resting on these dead trees. And I know Faith was wondering if that was for any particular reason. Now, Faith, remember when you've got massive wings like that, it actually is easier to sit in a dead tree when there's not a lot of foliage around. So I think that they would prefer to sit in a tree like this. However, on a hot summer's day, I don't think they would mind sitting on the branch of a marula with a bit of shade if it has got some leaves. So I think it all depends. But I think for taking off, it's a lot easier to do it from a dead tree. Brian, can we go back into that vulture that we were just looking at? I just noticed something. Now, have a look at that vulture's crop. Can you see how full it is? You see there? It's sort of bulging from its neck. Now, I think that those lions have definitely moved from their carcass, and I think that's why these vultures have a bit of a full crop, is perhaps they got to scavenge on a few little bits. So maybe it would be worthwhile us taking a little drive and heading back to that old site and just to have a look, because I haven't seen any tracks here just yet. So perhaps they still are in the same spot. But let's carry on while we've got a gap in the weather before it decides to come back down on us. We're going to go around. Oh, I think, what is coming up ahead? What? I've seen something. I saw something jumping. It could be an impala, I'm not sure, so I get very excited. I just want to have a very quick look at what it was. Please be the lions. Please, please, please be the little cubs running around. I don't think, no, it's impala, but... Impala, good morning. We haven't said hello to you yet. Right, let's try and get another little look at these impala. So I'm also just looking around me just to make sure that I don't miss the lions. Here we go, some impala. Right, now if you're not sure what this is an impala, which is the most common antelope in Africa, and we see them all the time. We've actually been quite spoiled this morning already. We've seen quite a few different birds already, quite a few different antelope species. The birds seem to be taking the lead this morning though. And good morning, Soraya. You want to know, are there more animal species before or after the rain? Now, it depends. If you've had a bit of a drought like what we've experienced, when we get our first rain, it's quite spectacular as to what you start to see. Because you get all the reptiles, all the tortoises, and all the interesting things, all the frogs coming out that we don't normally see in the dry conditions. So I'm going to have to say, after the first rains, I think we see many more species. Because not just the big mammals, but we start to see the reptiles, we start to see more insects, we start to see a few different things. I can see the impala also. Everybody's wet. They don't look too miserable though. They look all right. Listening carefully. Lovely. Now, as we're chatting about the rain and we're watching his damp impala, and on the topic of variety of species, Jason was wondering, are there any species of animals or creatures that we see out here that you only see in the rain? Now, something that we we see a lot of during the rain is normally, we're still waiting, is usually the African land snails. And I know there are a few viewers out there who are quite excited to see the first African land snails. We've just been seeing a lot of shells. And I'm trying to think what else we see just in the rain. Brian, can you think of anything that we just see in the rain? Not anything specific. But with apparently Birchall's cuckolds, because I haven't seen them yet, they only seem to come out with the rain. So I'm not 100% certain, though it is early morning and my mind could be boggled and there could be an easy example that I'm completely forgetting and missing. Let's carry on down the road. See, we're getting closer and closer to where the lions were last seen. So perhaps we're going to come up to them shortly. Just going to take a little drive along here. Should we do some raindrop appreciation? Very squeaky. Look how pretty those raindrops are. I want to very quickly show you Brian's magic camera work, but just how beautiful is this? This is something we don't often get to see and something we don't spend time with. But look at all those lovely droplets. It's beautiful. It's so lovely this morning. It's not too wet, but sort of just the right amount of a drizzle that we've had. It sort of has revitalized everything. That's beautiful. I love the way that the morning light is catching those droplets. You're going to see lots of very happy insects that will drink the water from the droplets. There's not really any puddles that are formed on the ground for them to drink from and all. So anything that's up there will be utilizing the little droplets so that are caught by the leaves and by the grass. Isn't that nice? To finally see the lovely bright shades of green that are popping in the dark gray vegetation. Now, let's carry on though. I think let's continue our search for the wonderful ngurhumas. We're just going to head up around the corner. Go jigger. Right. So, have anybody heard a woodlands kingfisher just yet? I'm wondering, because I haven't been out, don't get to go out all the time. I'm just wondering, I haven't heard anything just yet. I'm sure they're going to plague us around the camp, which will be great. I'm excited to see them. Now, I'm going to keep you updated with my search, but while I carry on attempting to track the ngurhumas, James got something colorful for you.
Snake, everybody, retrieved this very morning by Peter Bratt at the Gari Repeater, where he was doing some technical stuff. Ooh, it's got a bit of a niff to it. It's obviously quite fresh, and it's probably wet from the rain, not from the snake itself. But I'm going to leave. Oh, that really doesn't smell nice at all. Okay, thank you, Peter, for that. Now, let's have a look over here. We had a question from Jason about looking at butterfly scales under the microscope. There are a little collection of butterflies. This is a wonderful collection of insects from the University of Pretoria. And what we'll do is put the microscope over there and have a look-see. On the weather front from outside the tent, it does look like it's starting to clear a bit, but I'm not sure how much it's going to. So we'll give it a little bit more time here and then we might think about going out. So there are the scales on a butterfly's wings. Now those are those little squares there. They are what give the butterfly its colors. And you can see that they come off. You can see they don't stay on forever. And that is the kind of thing that comes off in your hands when you pick up a moth. Is that cool? I think that's really quite cool. Now there's its head. You can see its eyes and its feelers and its little mouth parts. Rebecca has described this as super pretty. It looks like a mosaic. Yes, indeed. Rebecca, of course, is a millennial. And so words like, or descriptors like super pretty are, well, relevant. Right, there we are. Okay, let's have another look. What I'm going to do is try and set up another shot of a moth here and just see if we can see the difference. We can, actually. Have a look at that. That's the moth's wing. And moths tend to be, I guess, a little bit more hairy than butterflies. You can see there, but there you can see the scales as well. Very similar. And also the veins in which the hemolymph keeps the hydraulic pressure up that keeps the wings taut. Isn't that cool? I think that's rather gorgeous, don't you, David?
Yep.
Yes. Good. That is the that's the pin that has pinned this moth into its cage. I don't know why I think that's funny, David. I'm sorry. Right. Okay, that's the moth. Very nice. Now, I have drawn something very special for everybody, and as you all know, I'm a spectacularly good artist. And so what we're going to do is go and have a look at my sublime drawing, and then we're going to see how good Steph is at drawing. I did this for our rehearsal yesterday, and I drew a family tree, if you like, of the leopards of this area. I left out Karula's parents, and I put in, of course, that's Karula there. That's her crown. And I put in her spot pattern. You can see she has three spots on her right, our left, and four the other side, three, four. Then we have Shadow over here. Very nice. She's also got a crown, but it's a bit smaller. She too is three, four on either side of the nose. And I'm going to explain what I mean if you don't know very shortly. Then there is, of course, over here, Tandi. Tandi has got two babies herself. She is 3-3, is Tandi. We don't know what those babies are, male or female. Then Karula, of course, has had four litters. So, well, five litters, and four she's raised to independence. So we've got that litter and those ones there. We won't worry about that. And then she, of course, has little Hosana and little Shongile. There is Hosana, and he is 3-3. And Shongile is 4-3. I think she's 4-3 and not 3-4, if I'm not mistaken. So that's how it works. Now, if you draw a nose of a cat, which looks something like that, David?
Yes.
Yes. You see how it looks exactly like a cat, with the nostrils as such. But if, I actually can't picture it now. If... Let me do that once more. It's really depressing when you can't draw. I'm just going to draw that little shape there. Now, that's the mouth. Of course, you can see there, that's the mouth of the cat. And above it, there will be the whiskers. And above the whiskers kind of are dotted around there like that. And above the whisker line, you will have this distinct spotting. So on Karula, who is our most famous, she's three here. She's got three. I'm not sure if they're exactly in a line. I forget. And then she's got four on this side. And that is how I always find it easier to identify leopards. Of course, Karula has a number of distinct different kinds of different kinds of spots. I'm laughing now because Rebecca has said, when we're ready, we're going to show you a clip of Hosana having his mistakes fixed by his mother, the Queen.
He's about to give us another demonstration of his problem-solving abilities. Oh, shame. Oh, dear. He's about to go head over heels out of the tree. I mean, how on earth he's balancing that is the least elegant position I've seen a leopard in a long time. But somehow it's working for him. He's managed to get his head into the carcass itself. And at least he's given up chewing the piece of skin that was holding it on, which was what he was doing earlier. Oh dear, little one. The situation that her cubs have put her in. Let's see if she's any better at this than Hosanna is. Too much happening here. There's a harrier hawk flying overhead. There's Karula pulling the kill into the tree. Let's watch her do this. I'll keep an eye on where the harrier hawk goes. Oh dear. This is a tricky spot, isn't it, Karula? Luckily, you've got a bit more strength than your... Oh, shame. Oh dear, that wasn't very easy, was it? Well done, clever girl. Much better, sort of. Not the most stable of branches, but at least it's up. I mean, that takes some serious skill. It's basically, imagine if you had to try and eat your dinner with no knives and forks hanging from a marula tree with your claws. It's not all that easy. Especially since the impala meat's quite tough for tiny teeth and tiny jaws. So it's difficult for them to really get in there properly. Wow. That was an impressive display of strength. She hasn't thought it through though, because that impala ram's horns are going to get stuck. But that was seriously impressive. He's about to give us another demonstration.
And that, everybody, is why she's managed to raise herself 10 litters of cubs, or 5 litters of cubs. Now, have a look over here. My friend Stefan has drawn a very beautiful map. Can you see that? That is Africa, everybody. What do you think, David? You think he's a better artist than I am? Definitely not. Good answer, David. Well done. That's where we are there. That is the Kruger National Park down there, signified by a K. This is what one might describe as minimalist art, I think. Now, what I wanted to draw for you here is the escarpment. So this is the mountains of South Africa, the Drakensberg. They stretch up there like that. And on top of that is the plateau region. I'm going to call this P for... No, I won't. I'm going to call it H for Highveld. And I'm going to call this L for Lowveld. Now, when people came... Well, the first people to be in South Africa were unquestionably the... Well, initially it was the Australopithecines, I suppose. But the first anatomically modern human beings probably left their descendants as the Bushmen or the Sand people that still live in South Africa to this day. So they were here, we'll say, forever. Then coming down from the sort of equatorial regions here, there was a migration of what we call the Bantu people, and they are now the vast majority of the people in South Africa. And we think, quite unlike the politicians would have had us believe during much of the 20th century, that the archaeological evidence shows that the Bantu people have been in this area specifically for at least the last 1,000 years or so. So they came down in two waves. One came down the central regions on the plateau. Look how beautiful my arrow is, David. Isn't that nice? Yes. And then another bunch came down the coastal regions. There. Oh dear, my second arrow didn't go so well. And in the Highveld region here, this group turned into the people that spoke the languages of Sotho and Pedi, so the Sotho languages, which are distinct from the Nguni languages that came down the coast, and these turned into the people that now talk isiXhosa or Zulu, both of which are very similar. So those are 4 of the languages that are spoken in South Africa. They are similar and they're related to each other, and they're part of a language group called the Niger-Congo and a smaller group called the Bantu languages, and they all actually are related to the languages of the people spoken up in this region here, and that's why how we know that they came down. Well, that's how linguistically we can tell that they are related. So that's happened there. Then, of course, we had one more migration of people down this end. Well, not so much a migration, but there was a dwelling of people here, and these were the, what do we call, the Khoisan, and they were living around this area here. This is where the Cape is, when the white settlers arrived circa 1652. Jan van Riebeek and his boat, the Dromedaris, which is not a relevant part of Safari Live. Now, a nice question from the name, I'm afraid I've forgotten, about what incident caused the most effect on African wildlife. And I'm going to bring Stefan in here and see if he agrees with me. I would have said it was the advent of ivory hunting. Would you have said?
Yeah. Commercial trade in meat, I think, was what I would say. So okay. Spring, the blue buck, which occurred over here, was almost completely wiped out due to the food needs of Cape Town, and obviously Cape Town being a trade route, joining the European and Americas to the east, basically, and the trade routes in the east. So they used to restock with food and vegetables, and they wiped out an antelope called the blue buck. They also did significant damage to springbuck populations. And then with the finding of gold on the Highveld, the need for food wiped out the springbuck populations in the center of the country, and had lots of damage on ivory, but meat trade. So by the time the 1900s came along, there was very few animals in the Kruger National Park whatsoever. No elephant.
Like 10 elephant when the Kruger Park was, or the Sabi Game Reserve was designated in 1898, I think.
Yeah, I read a crazy fact saying that there were footprints in 1900, there were footprints seen in the Kruger National Park of some elephant, and then in 1903 or 1905, three or five elephant walked across from Mozambique into the Kruger Park. So today we have, I don't know, anywhere between 16,000 and 17,000, yeah. So I would say that people had the largest impact on the local wildlife, and then second to that disease, I think. But that's been going on forever, so... Yeah.
But that's quite interesting, and what is noticeable, of course, is that for 1,000 years or so before the advent of the colonists with the guns, basically, and the advent of commercialism, I suppose, in South Africa, the animals here lived... Now, I don't believe in the term harmony with man. I don't believe any creature lives in harmony with any other creature, but there was a balance, a dynamic equilibrium between predator and prey. And the local people here had an almost negligible effect on animal populations. It was only with the advent of commercial ivory hunting, commercial meat hunting, which of course was brought about by the need, as Steph says, just to keep you posted, that this is where Johannesburg is. That's the gold mines that Steph's talking about. This was the Cape over here where all that farming was done. And of course there was diamond around here in Kimberley. So it was diamonds and gold that probably drove the extinction of those massive, massive herds of springbok. Millions and millions and millions of springbok that were taken out.
For very similar hunting. To the bison in North America, just to feed people, really. Now, Stalker's asked, while we're looking at sort of paleoanthropology, Stalker's asked, what, if any, dinosaur bones have been found in South Africa? Stalker, there's quite a lot, in actual fact. There's South Africa pretty much leads the race underneath a doctor called Guy Berger at the moment in terms of human evolution and human-like forms, I suppose, or human-like species evolution. In terms of dinosaurs, quite a few dinosaur bones have been discovered in South Africa. I'm not an archaeologist. For me to say exactly where and what significant finds, I can't. Other than there are around Clarence, which is around here in the Drakensberg, there are some footprints, fossilized footprints of some dinosaurs. But, you know, good question there, Stork. You know, for me, it's unanswerable. I just know that South Africa leads, in paleoanthropology, it leads the race in terms of fossil finds, or significant fossil finds, at least anyway, recently. But in terms of dinosaurs, I'm not too sure at all.
As far as I'm aware, we don't have any of the kind of iconic dinosaurs. There are no T-Rexes or Brontosauruses or anything like that that have been found here, but there are smaller examples of them. All right, Taylor is still braving it out there. I feel slightly bad, but not really. Let's go and find out how that's going.
We've just come to check where James said he heard the very lion-sounding noises. Now, I only can see lots and lots of impala. We're back on Mvubu Road again. I'm just trying to very quickly have a chat with Mike and Andrew to find out what was happening with Karula. Can you copy me now? They don't seem to be able to hear me very well. Let's try it again. Mike, if you can copy me, I'm trying to find out what the last location of a Karula was. I'm just trying to see if there's anything happening with Karula. Yes, I wasn't in that sighting. That's why I'm asking what the location of that sighting was. It'd be just a moment. Well, they're just quickly listening. Right. I'm having a little listen. Okay, very interesting. Copy, thank you. Right, so I've just got some very interesting news that perhaps Karula could still be around, which is quite exciting. I'm not having very much luck with the Ngahumas, and I suspect that they've gone down into the drainage because we've driven here and I haven't seen any more tracks. I did see some tracks on Twin Dams Road. Sorry, it's very, very squeaky, I'm afraid. And the tracks were going up and down, so I suspect one set of tracks was coming to drink and the other set was going away, but they disappeared. And with the ground being so hard now and the tracks not showing so nicely, I wasn't able to establish exactly where they were going to and which drainage line they disappeared down on, because they're definitely not on any of the roads. So I'm going to give it one more go, and then if I don't get lucky, I'm just double triple checking everywhere that I look, then perhaps we're going to try and follow up on Karula and see if she is not around in the same spot. I'm not sure how much meat would be left though with those two hungry cubs. They would have gutsed, I'm sure, most of that impala. But let me just have another little scan here. The rain is now completely subsided, well, for the moment, so perhaps everything's going to come out of its hiding spot. Let's have a quick scan. I don't want to miss anything. No, it doesn't look like they're here. They must be in a drainage somewhere. And I did stop and have a little listen as well, but I couldn't hear any noises. This is interesting. Ooh. So, just double, triple checking. We've driven here before. I've checked the tracks. Still nothing new. Just want to double check down in here. Now, I don't know if you've noticed, but some of us keep getting the sniffles early in the morning, and that's because of all this weather that we've been having. One minute it's hot, next minute it's freezing cold. Our bodies don't really seem to know what to do. And Faith was wondering, are there any animals that sort of struggle with the hot and cold of the weather? I don't think so, Faith. I think the animals are a lot more equipped to drastic weather changes than we are. Remember, they've got the lovely coats of hair, or they've got feathers to keep them nice and warm, or they use a variety of different techniques to try and keep the temperature nice and warm. On the cold days, I think the reptiles obviously struggle, especially if it's been nice and hot, probably just starting to get back into routine, and then they've got to go back and hide away again because it's too cold. So I think insects and the reptiles, if anything, don't enjoy the cold weather, but everything else seems to carry on. I like the hot weather. Hot weather is my favorite, just because you know you're going to see lots of animals coming down to the watering holes if you haven't had too much rain. Now I'm going to just double, triple, quadruple check that they didn't maybe do a sneaky and come up here to one of their favorite roads, up Gowrie cut line. But no, it doesn't look like it. These footprints, so those lots of impalas. The impalas have all walked on top of each other and on each other's footprints. Oh, yes, thanks, Brian. I'm just doing a quick little circle over here. We're going to just carry on quickly checking. We had a roadblock. See if those lions have come down here. That's the problem. Sometimes you get your head so stuck down on the ground, you forget what else is around you. Let's see. No, it doesn't look like they've come here. But we will check this gharri cut line just in case. Remember when I was looking for the lions? No, was it yesterday? I think it was yesterday morning, yes. And we were tracking them all the way up on Biffle's Hook cut line. And then they were eventually found by good old Rex down quite not too far from quarantine. Now they have a habit of using these drainage lines to move in. So I am checking very carefully. Perhaps they are on the move. It's nice and cool, so it wouldn't surprise me if they perhaps are wandering around instead of sleeping. I think they'll take advantage of this cool, damp weather. Now this is a nice road because it leaves lots of wonderful footprints. So we would be able to see the lion's tracks quite easily if they walked out here. But otherwise, if they walked down in the drainage below us, that would be a little bit more difficult. And I'd have to rely, or like I'm doing now, on actually physically looking to spot them. Doesn't seem to be much happening around here. Naughty lions. Naughty, naughty, naughty lions. Oh, should we have a little look and see if we can perhaps find anything in this fallen marula tree? I'm going to jump off very quickly. You can hear, you know when I'm about to stop because the squeaks are quite impressive. I need to just rearrange my clothing again. It's now very wet and all stuck to me, so that's nice. Now, I just wanted to have a very quick look. You might see that I have a wet bottom. So Brian, don't just zoom in. So something like this, especially after a little bit of rain, would be quite nice to look for some insects, perhaps even a scorpion. Maybe it would have flushed them out, though it wasn't particularly hard. But I can see that the termites have completely devoured what once was, it looks like it was a marula at one point. This is quite old. It looks like a fire has gone through here too and perhaps burnt it away. But now we see a lot of the bark scorpions living in something like this. So I'm going to have a very quick little look and hope to not get stung in the process. But it doesn't seem like there's anybody home. And also obviously look around me and hope that there's no more buffalo or no lions. No, it doesn't look like there's much here. Quite interesting. Just lots and lots of bark, but no insects. I thought we were going to see some, at least find something creeping, crawling. I thought maybe even a millipede would have been lurking around here, feeding on all the dead leaves that are surrounding this marula, but apparently not. We will jump back in again. We'll continue the search. I've got a fall. So I can avoid getting a wet bum again. This is what went down to my pants earlier. I don't know if you can see. Can you see all that wonderful water? Isn't that amazing?
It's wonderful.
Is it wonderful? Now, I don't want that to go on. Oh, we've got the antlion again. Sorry, I got distracted. Can we see it? Look at it, it's sitting so nicely. Hi, antlion. There it is. Now, I'm not going to touch it this time because I don't want it to fly away. Now, you can see those clubbed antennae that I was talking about. Whereas the dragonflies don't have that. And, of course, the wings resting against its body. Whereas a dragonfly would have its wings sort of splayed out. Isn't that beautiful? Now, you unfortunately cannot live on the canvas because I suspect you will get squashed and we don't want you to get squashed. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to release it. This would be a good meal for a bird. I'm going to try and catch it so it's going to disappear, but I want to put it out. Now the rescue mission is complete and let's pour the water out at the same time. No more wet bums, no more wet bums. Okay, let's put you on the stick. No, not on the stick, it's flying. Okay, well it can fly away then. Right, get plugged back in again. Okay, I'm in. I can breathe again. Ooh, hello. bit excited. Jigga obviously missed me. Let's carry on. I'm hearing all sorts of wonderful things in my ears. And they're having a conversation. I think they're discussing if they're going to have tea and scones for breakfast this morning. Now, there doesn't seem to be too much happening down this road. So, like I said, I definitely suspect that those lines are moving in the drainage line somewhere. But I think what we're going to do is we're going to carry on. I'm going to give the lions a skip this morning. We'll let them get away with it, unless perhaps if you see them pop out on the dam cam somewhere, please let me know. You can either hashtag Safari Live, or you could also send us a message, an email, questions at wildearth.tv. And I think what I would like to do, seeing as I haven't seen any leopards since I've been back at work, is possibly try and follow up on Karula. Now, I couldn't quite understand what Andrew was saying, just there was a little bit of interference with the radio. So hopefully once I get a little bit further east, they'll be able to hear me a bit better. But it sounded like something that I should go and check the last area that Karula was seen. I think it was Brent yesterday. So that's basically what we're going to go and do and have a look at. So you're going to hear me chatting away now. Rebecca, I am on Rusty. Rebecca just wanted to quickly find out something, what channel of communication I am on. Who else have we got here? Where are all the little creepy crawlies? The millipedes. I'd like to see a millipede this morning. If you have anything that you'd perhaps like to see that maybe you haven't seen for a long time, let me know. And then we can try and find it. And that's perhaps why we're having a quiet. So you better send in your orders quickly. And now all the birds have gone. I was saying to Brian that it's bizarre how always on the cloudy, overcast, rainy days we see so many more birds than we do on the lovely blue, clear skies when it has an amazing backdrop. And now, as I said that earlier, the birds have all seemed to have disappeared as well. Okay, what else do we have over here? We've got a bird. What bird do we have up in the top of the tree? Can you see it up there? What are you? Are you a starling of some sort? Yes, it looks like a violet-backed starling, doesn't it? Does it? Are you? I think you are, but I can't see very well because... Yes, it is. Look at that. You see, I was looking at a bit of a silhouette, and that looks like a violet-backed starling.
So unfortunately, we experienced some tech difficulties. That's one of the things about being live and in the bush, but our tech crew is on it and not asleep like the lions behind me. Hopefully we'll be back with you shortly.
Thank you. sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush.
Well, good afternoon again. Good morning, sorry. Yes, we've magicked ourselves into Rusty. Rusty is driving. We've had a couple of issues on account of the rain. There was an overheating battery and some communications that didn't work, and so I must apologize for the technical loop that you had to go to. I'm not sure what happened to Jigger or why Taylor lost signal, but there it is. Now, let's try and go and find the lions. We'll see what we can find. We might also pop across to the far east to see if Karula is still around there. I'm not sure where Taylor is, but I'll get an update from her on the game drive very shortly. Now, I've also had to get a new earpiece, which I've taped into my ear by means of gaffer tape. Lovely. Yes, very attractive. I've had a number of troubles with it, and in fact, it's made me say some bad words earlier on. Right, there we are. Let's see if we can't find some lions. I suppose on a day like today, the lions will be moving around because it is quite cold. In fact, it is very cold. Now Taylor is on cheetah cut line and going to see Karula. That is very good news indeed. Sorry, I'm just trying to fix this thing. There we are. So we're going to go down towards the Galago Pan. I thought those lions were calling really not too distant past, somewhere around here, so we might be lucky. There's a breeze blowing. The sky is scudding grey, as you've seen already, but the clouds seem to have lifted slightly, which means I don't know how much more rain we'll have this morning. As I say that, a spot of rain has hit me on the face. Let's see what's going on. There's some impala, David. Can you believe our luck already? Starting out very well. Let's see if we can get a view of them. They're not looking very happy, I must confess to you. Look, it's not the best impala sighting we've ever had, but we'll make the most of it for now. There we go. And they're not looking very happy, of course, because it's cold. They don't like to be cold. Well, no animal likes to be cold. Oh, and in the background, the first time I've heard it this year, I'm sure you may have heard it before. Can you hear? I'm so sad. I'm so sad. That, of course, everybody, the black cuckoo. I think quite a nice nickname for the black cuckoo would be the funeral bird. It does sound so deeply miserable. Why wouldn't it be? It's quite blustery. Hello, Courtney. A very good question from you. I'm going to keep driving while I answer it. You say, with regard to the horns, are they purely for defense? Would they ever use them against predators, or would they only fight each other with them? Courtney, it really depends on the size of the animal. And the way you can tell whether they use them to fight each other or for defense against predators is to ask yourself, do the females also have horns? So in most of the antelope out here, in fact, everything sort of below the size of a nyala, the females do not have horns. Then, when you get to the size of a wildebeest, a kudu being a notable exception actually, you find that the females do start to have horns. Now, there are a couple of things that I think you can say about that. Buffalo, wildebeest, gemsbok, which is another word for gemsbok, is an oryx. What else would have horns as females? Anyway, let's just go with those ones for now. What you find is that they live out in slightly more open areas, and they are big enough to be obvious enough to live in a herd. So it's a combination of factors that combines to make the females have horns as well, and the ones with the females that have horns, you can be fairly sure, are the ones that defend themselves against predators with their horns, as opposed to just use them for fighting, which is what the impala do, for example. Okay, let's head across to Taylor. She's got something small, but something that will be big later.
We've managed to find an elephant. Have a look at this elephant that we've seen. It's so sweet, it's tiny. We've actually found a little family of elephants. There's quite a young one, and it's quite cheeky. Just as we arrived at the sighting, it was not very impressed with us. Ears all flared and sort of mock charging us. So I suspect now that mom has arrived, perhaps it'll be a little bit braver, maybe give us a little bit of a charge again. There's nothing quite sweeter than a baby elephant running at your vehicle. We obviously don't want mom to do that. Now, it's a relatively young elephant. I think it's probably almost about 6 months old now. You can see it just in hot pursuit, not leaving mom's side, trying to pick up all the little bit of vegetation. They can actually use its trunk quite well, and that's why I said that I reckon it's around 6 months or so. I think I need to go forward just a little bit, just so that you can get a better shot, perhaps a little bit backwards, I think. No, oh, I'm trying to multitask. Oh, come on, Rust, Jigger. Jigger, you can do it. Okay, there we go. They're moving pretty quickly. I'm gonna keep trying to go back. Oh, it looks like our short trunk female. Now that I've had a proper look at her, I'm gonna keep going backwards and just try and get ahead. But maybe it's our little friend who's a little bit older. I'm just trying to reverse and multitask. So it seems like it's short trunk and her fandamily that are all here. Hello, guys. Just gonna go back a little bit. And here, there's the other member. They're gonna come straight to us. Hello. Oh yeah, I parked on a little bit of a decline. Hello, I haven't seen our lovely short trunk female for ages. Hello, little one. They all look a little bit wet, but not too wet. Now, I'm sure a few of you are wondering, and if you have been watching and following closely, but you may remember this herd that chased the lions around, which was quite exciting. Now, she's obviously, there's only four of them in this herd. So when they do come across something like a lion, they do need to try and protect that little one, because they don't have sort of strength in numbers, I suppose, when you're with a big group of elephants. Isn't that wonderful? Now, there's many, many things I want to show you this morning. I'm sure you noticed my friend who was crawling around me and on my hat, Mr. Shongololo. Sean the Shongololo. I'm going to name the Shongololo after my youngest brother. As you can see, it crawling on my arm. Now, you were lucky I didn't let up a yelp, because it started tickling my face. I'm going to just try and creep my elbow. Don't fall now, because if you fall, we're going to lose you. I'm very impressed that it's able to stick to my jacket with its little legs. Oh, look, it's backing up. It's reversing. That's so funny. Watching its little legs as it moves around. Now it's going to come towards me. I'm going to try not to panic. It has also defecated all over me and all over Jigger. I'm going to have to do lots of cleaning up. Careful. You're gonna slide off. Yeah, see, it knows that it can't go too far back. Now, where's your next mover? You're gonna come right towards me. This is quite daunting. Let's see what it does. I'm going to be very brave. I'm going to try to sit very still. No, you can't go down there either. Watch it back up. This is quite funny. It realizes that it goes too far. Oh, no, no. Don't go. You're going to fall. I think it's trying to get to my hand. Yes, that's exactly what it's doing. I put my hand underneath my arm, and it seems to be reaching for my arm now. But look at those little legs. Those hundreds and thousands of little legs moving around, deciding what to do. That's quite impressive. And this is a big shongololo too. I don't think they get too much bigger than this. Okay, it's on my hand now. Now I'm trying to not do too many sudden movements because I don't want to get any more feces. I mean, you can see my hand is a disgusting color of black at the moment. That is a variety of feces, which I'm going to need to wash my hands, as well as from touching all the dirt on the floor when I picked it up. So I do apologize. My hands are not very clean right now. But isn't this a beautiful little creature? Now we're going to leave the elephants, and I'm also going to release the shongololo because I believe that Karula has been found, and that's definitely somewhere that I want to go. Look at this amazing critter. This is fantastic. You are wonderful. You really are. Right, I think it's time for us to pop him on a tree, though I don't know if it's a girl or a boy or what it is. And hopefully I don't die of cyanide poisoning. I'm sure you've heard it quite a few times that in the feces there's a small amount of cyanide. Now, off you go. Be free. Be free. Yes, you have. No, no, it likes me now. You can't come with me, I'm afraid. I'm not taking you away from your family. There we go. Take careful now, because that's a narrow one. You've got to be a trapeze artist. Come, take it. Doesn't want to let go. Let go. This is beautiful. Isn't that beautiful? And I'm just holding my arm steadily, because it hasn't quite taken most of its body onto the... Ooh, okay, I'm moving my hand away. I'm actually going to switch off so you... There we go, and we can watch it now. Now, careful, don't fall on the ground, because you've got thousands of people watching you. Look how it does a dance. See, now it uses its little feelers, those little antenna that you can see. Those are sort of feeling mechanisms. So they don't have any eyes. They've just got ganglia, sort of at the end of nerve ending, so they don't really have a brain either. And then just, that's how they use, or how they find their way around, is by those little antenna. Now you better be careful, as well. You better get your safe cover, because I'm sure there's lots of birds that would like to eat you. The African civets are also around. They love you, and you've got to be careful of the scorpions. This is so cool. You see even the little droplets on its feet. That is amazing. What are you trying to do? You've got the entire silver clusterleaf tree to crawl on, yet you are loving this little branch. Oh my word, doesn't that look like something out of a horror movie? Oh, you can see moving a little, but that's just the wind. Careful, shongololo. And you know, we call them shongololos, not millipedes in South Africa. We've got to give everything a strange name. You're doing quite well to stick out the little bit of wind that's now picking up. So now we're actually going to get freezing cold. That is so beautiful. What's it doing? Just having a little look now. Shongololo, if I were you, I'd go the other way, because you're going to end up going nowhere. Isn't that fantastic? And we're going to be start to see a lot more in a variety of shongololos. They don't just come in this sort of dark brown color. Sometimes we occasionally see some that are just covered with beautiful variety of different colors. So sometimes they've got bright red legs, which is quite amazing to see. They really do stand out. I've even seen millipedes with red bodies and orange on them. I'm sure that they're probably a little bit more toxic than the one that we're looking at now, displaying that those lovely colors. But that'll be something else that I'd like to show, hopefully find over the next few weeks as we get a bit more rain. Isn't that amazing? I can't believe that something this large is able to balance on a small little twig that it's on. It's doing very, very well. And I'm sure it'll make its way down to the ground eventually. I just put it on a tree because I found it on a tree. And it will make its way down and then start feeding on all the lovely dead leaves. That is awesome. Well, I think we're going to move on from Mr. Shongololo, Sean the Shongololo. And we're going to try and perhaps find Karula. So while I try and make my way into the Karula sighting, let's go back to James, who's finally on or inside his little car.
I am giggling quietly to myself, everyone, because I keep forgetting David doesn't have any communications with the final control, and he was telling me a naughty story when suddenly I realized he was about to tell it to all of you, and I'm glad he didn't. Now, over there is a duiker, and while we look at it disappearing into the bush is the prerogative of duikers, being the divers that they are. I thought I would just tell you that the lions we checked for around the Gallagher Pan, and then we came up towards the old hyena den on Mvubu Road, didn't find them there. So we're going to go around onto the Bifosok cut line and across to the Gowrie cut line, which is just sort of the road off to the east of where we are now. So that's over that direction there. And the reason we're doing that is because we thought we heard them in this area just before we came live on the vehicle. They've been calling from different areas, probably different groups of lions. Anyway, so we thought this was our best bet, but we haven't seen any tracks, and it's quite possible that they're in the middle of this block here, but we haven't seen their tracks coming in or out because of the rain from last night, which of course is a blessing, is it not, David?
Yes, David.
Yes, it is. Ooh, there. There's a very large bird being chased by a fork-tailed drongo. You are unable to see it. I'll see if I can get into a position. Nip up onto the firebreak here. I think it was a gymnogene or African harrier hawk. They're shouting. No, I think it's flown off, I'm afraid, everyone. Oh, there it is. David's going off in front to the right. They're quite reticent, the gymnogenes or African harrier hawks, and I think that's because they know that their deeds are dastardly. They filch little chicks out of their nests and eat them. It's not very nice, is it, David? No, not at all. We'll just have a look at the roller that was shouting at it first. Now, of course, a roller is going to have a problem with the gymnogene because a roller is a hole nesting bird, and the gymnogene is very well adapted to sticking its foot into tree holes and pulling out the chicks and whatever else they can find inside. Not the best roller picture we've had, is it, David? Difficult light, really. Yes. Okay, good. That was the lilac-breasted roller. Let's press on. See if we can't find a lion. Rebecca thinks it's still pretty. That's very nice. Thank you, Rebecca. You can have that roller as your dedicated sighting for the morning. She says, I'm very kind, everybody. I'm sure you'll all agree. There it is. I saw it fly again in front of us. But it's really staying in front of us. It doesn't want to be seen by the car, the African harrier hawk. Oh, on to the top. Now, I wonder if they've had any rain down in the south, which of course they hadn't up until fairly recently. There goes this bird, and that's why we've had so many buffalo up here. Oh, it's being smashed by the drongos. Hang on. See if I can get a little bit closer. There. I love those drongos. They are so vicious. And that Jimnogene or African harrier hawk is either molting its tail feathers or it's had one pulled out by perhaps, it could be a predator or perhaps even a very brave drongo, but it was missing a tail flight feather. Now, we'll just keep an eye on the ground for tracks of lions. I haven't seen any tracks of the lions, and obviously now they've stopped calling completely. What we'll do is turn the engine off here, and we'll roll down this hill. Even this hill should be steep enough to pull these aging Land Rovers down without the need for an engine. And once again, I do apologize for the technical loops we've had. I think the rain generally just causes things to not function particularly well. But here we are, out in the wilderness, searching, live. And you can and must please send us your questions and comments. Hashtag SafariLive, questions at wilder.tv. Terms and conditions apply. Hello, Leah. But a nice question from you about whether or not the animals out here, any of them enjoy the rain more than they enjoy the heat. It's an interesting one because what is enjoyment? Of course, we could get into discussion for hours on that. And how does an animal sense or think about enjoyment? And I was having this discussion with VM yesterday about the lions and whether they feel cold or... I mean, they do feel cold, but do they acknowledge that as unpleasant, or is it just, oh, I'm cold now? Because they don't kind of tend to look, it's difficult to tell if they're feeling miserable or if they're feeling happy or just kind of their physiology is registering cold and therefore making them warmer. It's quite interesting to know. So I'm not very sure, but as far as heat and cold goes, I think, at least heat and rain, I think you'll find much like us, they love the rain to start with. After a hot day, it's a really nice sort of way to cool down. But then as they sit outside and the wind blows and they're all wet, I think they probably think, well, this isn't quite as good as we thought it was going to be. Right, we're now on the road to the east of where I said we were going to be. And I'm pretty sure that Taylor's driven up and down this road already this morning. But the lions were calling after she was last here, which tells me that maybe they were moving. Rebecca says she drove endlessly up and down this road. There's a squirrel alarm calling here. I wonder if the lions aren't down in the drainage. The squirrel could be alarming at anything though. And if you can hear it going tee 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 tee. I'm just trying to see if I can't see a predatory bird of some sort. We'll just do a little drive in there and poke our heads down into the drainage. What are you shouting at, squirrel? It's in this tree somewhere. Can you see it, Dave? No, it's not. It's on the ground there. Look. To the right? There, middle of the frame. Right, so I don't think it's a lion it's shouting at, nor do I think it's a leopard. I think it's most likely a snake of some sort or a predatory bird flying above. But it's not happy. He's quite sweet though, isn't he? Now that's the only squirrel species that we get here. That is the tree squirrel. And that one has an itchy nose and a dirty face and an itchy back. Isn't that sweet to watch? That is awesome. They are so sweet. Now, squirrel, before you fall too much in love with it, everybody, remember, it is a member of the order Rodentia. It's gone off to the left there, Davy. We've missed it now. Well, we haven't missed it. It's gone behind a bush. Order Rodentia, which means that it is a rodent. So, if you love squirrels, you must love rats. Do you love rats, David?
No.
You don't love rats? Why?
Don't like them.
You're not fond of the bubonic plague?
No.
Alrighty, let's carry on down here. That was very sweet indeed. Squirrel. I've had two domestic squirrel experiences, both ended in tragedy. In fact, I've yet to come across a situation where a wild animal raised by human beings has not ended in tragedy. The first rather sadly ended with this squirrel on a cold winter's night crawling into its owner's bed. And unfortunately she didn't realize and she rolled over sometime during the night. And when she woke up, the squirrel's new name was Flat Stanley. Which is not a very funny story, I suppose, but if you had a very macabre sense of humour, and I guarantee you there's at least one person in the final control laughing, I knew it, Rebecca is laughing her head off, then I suppose you might find it funny. Then the second one, Pieterkie, the squirrel, was raised by Greta at Ngala, and it used to sit on her shoulder all day long, and all the guests were introduced to it, and that was very nice. And then one day it climbed into a mapani tree outside Greta's room, and Greta was doing something in her house, and she heard suddenly the beating of wings and then the brief alarm call of a squirrel unused to death from above, and she looked outside to see an African goshawk swooping in, grabbing the squirrel and making off with his dinner. It was very sad, and this is why I'm extremely reticent to take or raise wild animals, and we have a situation in our current camp where we haven't quite domesticated one, and I say we, I don't mean me, I mean some members of the camp who shall remain nameless, but they have got a squirrel there. He's completely free to move as he likes, but he's become quite habituated to us. His name is Potato. I don't know why his name is Potato, but that is his name. And, well, I know that inevitably tragedy will ensue. And that is just the way of things. Anyway, he'd be dead if we hadn't helped him. So at least he has a little bit more life before tragedy will inevitably strike. Beautiful crested barbet's just flown across the road. Can you see it there? Just middle of frame. Left. Up, 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 up. There, middle frame there. Oh, he's gone away. How's a crested barbet, everybody? Looking for fruits, sharpening his beak on the branches. Now, there are no lion tracks around here. I don't know where those things have gone. Taylor is almost with Karula the leopard, so hopefully we will have a cat sighting before too long. And I will keep looking for these lions, because they are around here somewhere. I'm not sure if she checked the last location of their buffalo. Did she, Rebecca? Silence. Ah, she did. Okay. Okay. So apparently they went down Twin Dams today. Well, I'm sure she drove Twin Dams, so what we'll do is drive Vulture's Nest Road. Twin Dams basically goes down in front of us and then veers to the left. We'll go down Vulture's Nest and see if they haven't come across the great Nloamati drainage. Righty. Yes, I did see Taylor doing this area from the tent many times during the course of this morning, as she bravely stayed out, but at the same time had to stay close enough to home that if the rain really started, she could get back. While the brave men, Steph and James, sat in the tent in relative warmth. I think it was quite a good plan of ours, don't you, David? It's called girl power. Right, let's head across to Girl Power and find out how her search for Karula's going. I think it's gone pretty well.
Ah, look at what we've got. Isn't this amazing? This wonderful leopard, and I'm sure she needs absolutely no introduction. But it is indeed Madam Karula. Now don't fear, the cubs are around. They were here just a moment ago and they've gone on a little wander. Oh, there they are. Good spotting, Brian. Just watching and listening in the distance, they are getting to that age where they're becoming quite curious. So perhaps they spotted a crested Franklin or something on the ground, maybe a scrub hare, and it caught their attention. Now, Karula's slightly panicked by this because they got up and ran away from her and are going on their own mission. So she's just keeping a close eye on them. I suppose with all the scares over the last couple of weeks with the baboons, she doesn't want them getting too far out of her sight. But let's hope that there's no more of that. So she's just seeing. They're not too far from her. They're probably about 30 meters away or so. She can see them. Now I think she's sort of giving them the death stare that moms normally give their children. I know I used to receive it from my mother quite often when we were in the shopping centres. And I would run around with my little brother, not Sean the Shongololo, but just Sean. And she would then glare from one end of the shopping centre. We knew we had to come back or we'd be in trouble. Now, she's munching on the head of the impala. So that says to me that there's absolutely nothing left of that kill. They've completely devoured it. And hopefully those little ones come back again. I think they're itching slightly closer. So as you can see, she's licking away, trying to get rid of all that hair. So to turn the game drive radio down. Here we go. And one of the other cubbies are coming back. We'll see who it is now. It looks maybe it's Shongile. You can see in the corner of the screen. I'm going to take a few screenshots because I don't think I've seen Shongile yet. I've only seen Hosana. But we'll have a look. Hopefully the little one comes a bit closer. So remember, we absolutely love it when we're able to see the photos that you send us. So remember to hashtag Safari Live, or you can even send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. Let's see who this is now. It's quite difficult to tell just from here because I'm also not used to the two of them and the size comparison. But this one did look slightly smaller. So I have a suspicion that, like I said, it is Shongile. And her brother has gone wandering off a little bit further, perhaps. But Mom is obviously a lot happier now that she can see her little darlings. And they haven't wandered too far out of view. Finally, it took us long enough to get here. I'm so sorry about that. I must apologize. I kept getting distracted by all the different things. Here the little one comes and we were able to have a good view now. Now, if you know who this is, you've seen this little leopardess, if it is the leopardess, more often than I have. Maybe you could help me with IDing. Maybe if there are any identifying features. But it is tough at this age when they're not standing together, but I suspect, like I said, I think it is definitely Shongile. Come on, Hosana, where are you? Come and join us. I want to see both of you with Mum. Just hiding behind the silver cluster leaf.
It's amazing how these branches are placed perfectly to obstruct our view. Anna Marie, I'm so happy that you are enjoying this and that we managed to find them. Because you've said that you were a bit nervous after the scare that they had with the baboons, and it is very, very scary, of course. Now, of course, it is all nature, that as all this has to happen. But we're very lucky that on two occasions, Karula has just proven to be fantastic at what she does. And you can see, is that Osana back there, Brian? I can't even see where that is. I'm looking on my little screen. Oh, there we go, come back. I think, I can see where you're looking now. Okay, yes, you see, that's just why I think it is. Oh, you see, they're very curious as all the birds flying over. I'm just watching them occasionally lift their heads. Come on, come back to us now. He's slowly making his way here. And you see that, how Shongile is quite interested into everything flying over the top of her head. Like I said, they're becoming very inquisitive. They're 8 months now. They're getting nice and big. They're doing very well. And I can't wait to be a part of, perhaps see when they catch their first hunt, go for their first hunt. Even if it is something like a little bird, or even a scrub hare, a mouse. Wouldn't that be so exciting to see how far these little ones have come, while Mom continues to nibble on the face of that impala, and she rightfully deserves to eat the last remnants, as she does all the hard work. See how she's now using her paw to try and pull chunks of meat off, which she's doing very, very well. And you'd be surprised at how much flesh is actually on the face, around the cheeks. And I know the cheeks of many animals are considered a delicacy throughout the world. And to a leopard, it's delicious. Every part of an animal is delicious. Well, that piece didn't look too great. She seems to spit it out a little bit. She's crunching away. Just also trying to separate the flesh from any little bones or perhaps any skin. Now we've got a lovely obstructed view of her face. Thank you, Karula. But she's a lovely leopardess. I hope that today at some point, it is a lovely cool day, this is great hunting weather, and that she does perhaps is able to catch and maybe a little common dacre. There's lots of them running around, or even better, another impala, which will keep them filled for a few days. And I love that you call them the royal family. I definitely think they are such regal animals. And who is the king again? Is Tingana the king or is Mvula the king? I've forgotten now. So if you can help me out with that, I've forgotten who we refer to as the king out of the leopards. I think it's Tingana. Look at those canines. See, just munching and always looking over her shoulder. She seems to be a little bit more nervous than what she normally is. I remember the last time that I saw Karula, that was a good chunk of flesh, she was very much relaxed. But she also hadn't had any of her scares yet, I don't think, from either of the baboon sightings. And now you see how she takes a bite, she stops, she listens, she looks over her shoulder to make sure no one's trying to sneak up on her. It's not just her that she has to worry about. I think it was just her on her own, she'd be very much relaxed. There you go, she's taken that jaw apart now, which is great because she cannot eat the flesh on the inside, which there seems to be quite a bit of. And the day is brightening up as well. It's really lovely. I thought that they weren't going to be here this morning. That's why I didn't even think to come and check. I thought there's no ways. Those little gutsy kids of hers would have eaten every last scrap. And it seems as though it's the other way around. Karula's, in fact, eating the last of the scraps. Excuse me, sorry. I've got a little tickle in my throat. I'm going to have to take a sip of water. Ah. There we go. That feels a little bit better. Here we go. Coming back over to Mum. Coming over very sheepishly. And I wonder if she's, the young girl's going to get reprimanded by Mom for going on a wonderabout without her permission. Or perhaps she's also just trying to eat and protect the last of the carcass, because she knows if she lets it go, she's not going to get anything back. Now let's see if we can have a look here as to who this actually is. Like I said, I need your help. But I'm going to take one or two pictures. What are you doing? You're trying to steal. Look at that. Trying to steal the last bit of the carcass that's on the ground from away from Mom. Or are you just going to play with it now? Yeah, I'm going to play with it. Oh, that's lovely. Ah, thank you, James Richard. I'm very confused. So James says that this is Hosanna. So James, I would like to know, how exactly do you know this is Hosanna? Because at the moment, they're so small. And I know when they're together, it's very easy to tell the difference because of their size. And obviously, you can look once again at the bits that make a girl, and a boy, a boy. However, with Hosanna, it's quite difficult because his bits are not quite well developed yet, which makes it a little bit difficult for us. So was it the spots that you were perhaps looking at? Like I said, I haven't seen Shongile, so I don't know how slight she is or how stocky she perhaps is compared to her brother, of course. Both of them. Both Mom and son having a lovely snack. This is beautiful. Hosanna, you are an absolute delight to photograph. Isn't he just such a photogenic cat? Now, Shongile, feel free to come back at any moment so we can have a look at you. So what I've tried to start doing is form an ID kit for myself so that I do get familiar with all the various animals and, of course, the cats who play a very important role in the story that we have to share with you every day. So the missing... I've got a few missing cats still. I haven't got a photo of Shongile yet. Well, hopefully I'll get one today. I still need to see Mvula. I've only seen Tingana very briefly. I haven't seen this wonderful Anderson male that you're all talking about. Quarantine apparently is a stunner. There's so many leopards I've still got to see. But we're going to continue watching these wonderful cats munch away on their scraps. And while we do so, let's go back over to James, who's got a buffalo.
Well, lions we haven't found, but we have found a breeding herd of buffalo here, and they're wandering in from the east towards the west. And I suspect, therefore, that they're probably... I'm not sure that... Was Taylor with some buffalo earlier? I think she may have been. Anyway, if she was, I think these were them. But they're a herd coming in from the east to west, and as I said... Lots of buffalo around at the moment. Normally, we don't have herds here. It's normally during the course of the summer, it's just the bulls lurking about in the puddles that we have. But now, with the rest of the Sabi sand and much of the Kruger still remaining in the grips of the drought, we've had these little groups of herds of buffalo coming through. And it's been really nice to see, especially for the lions. They've been very happy to see them. The Nkuhumas have eaten something silly. Brent was counting like 26 in the last 6 weeks. Or 4 weeks, I think it was. And didn't like the sound of that, did that buffalo cow? She had a little oxpecker sitting on her, of course. And you can hear them moving. Things are just warming up, everyone. The sun is breaking through the cloud. It's making for a fairly soporific atmosphere, especially out of the wind here. Also in the background, you might be able to hear the African cuckoo. Not an African cuckoo, sorry, a hoopoe. Going boop, 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 boop. Here they come down the road, isn't that cool? Why do they use the road, you might ask? Well, the answer is the same reason you do. Because it's just easier to move when you don't have to step over logs and trip into holes. I wonder if they won't settle here. They may well just settle here. And the other thing that Taylor mentioned, of course, during the course of her buffalo sighting, I remember now, was the fact that they were browsing. Now, both she and Brent said, not she and Jamie said, that they thought that was quite unusual. And I suppose it is. And had it not been for this year, I would have agreed with them completely. But I've seen these buffalo doing a lot of browsing during the course of this year. And so it's obviously not just the drought. They probably do a bit more browsing than we think they do. And if you look over there, Davey, the ones on the left-hand side there, they are eating some green stuff on... That's it, the ones that are just walking off. That's greenery, but it's not grass. It is browse. And the difference being it's a different kind of plant, and so it requires a slightly different kind of specialization for digestion. But I think buffalo, perhaps, in this area, slightly more mixed feeders than we think they are. And also... We often describe elephants as mixed feeders, but elephants will eat grass when they can. And so I think while most of these animals' preference would be to eat fresh grass because it doesn't have the chemicals that many of the sort of tree leaves have, I think you'll find that they're all adept browsers when they have to be. They always look a little bit morose to me. Hugely long tongues for breaking off the plants that they eat. And of course, no top teeth. That distinguishes most of the ruminants from many others, is the fact that they have no top teeth. Just a pad, a cartilaginous pad. And still they come down the road, streaming down the road. Hundreds of them, David. A great bevy of buffalo. Hello, David in Napa. A very nice question from you about the color of buffalo's horns. And you say, why are some of them black and some of them kind of multicolored? Well, I'm not sure I'd describe them as being multicolored. I might describe them as being sort of uneven brown. I think it's got very much to do with how much moisture they've got on them, David. The black ones are wet, and the browner ones tend to have no moisture and quite a lot of dust on them. So it depends what the buffalo's been doing. There are a few here, like the one that, yeah, that one's got completely black horns there. And I think if you look carefully, you can see a sheen of sort of moisture there. And I think the dust that makes them brown has just kind of washed off. And you can see there that bit of leaf, and I think that bit of leaf there indicates that buffalo has been rubbing its head through some wet vegetation. So that's all it is. Nothing more astounding than that. Now, Paul, you want to know if these are mostly female buffalo? Yes, they are. There is a cow. She does not have a boss or helmet coming out of her horns. And so she is definitely a female. And if you look at around, there are many, many females. I would say the while the majority of female is probably about I'm going to say 30% male, 35% male, 65% female in a breeding herd like this. All right, while they settle down to ruminate, let's head across to Taylor and find out how the queen is ruminating on her impala.
She's finished ruminating. They've actually now moved away completely from that kill site, and Shongile has again joined. There's Karula, and then we've got Shongile who's lying on the left and the silver cluster leaf, and she's now playing with the branches. Look at what is she doing? What technique is that? Is that the upside down leopard crawl? It looks as though it may be. And they're so funny at this age, how they're able to entertain each themselves and not really have to worry about mom too much. I'm sure mom is very much relieved that she had two cubs and that they've got each other to... Ooh, look at that. How agile is she? Isn't that beautiful? That is amazing. I think we're going to see some action with the two little ones. They seem to have woken up a bit now. Oh, now I can clearly see the size difference. And there the three of them go. Isn't that just an amazing coloration that they've got on them, especially at the moment? I can hear some impala in the distance too. And they're moving quite quickly.
Where are you guys going? Now, I hope they don't go into the thick vegetation because it's just me in the sighting, or Brian and I and the thumb in the sighting. And it's going to make it very difficult if they do decide to go through some nasty vegetation. We're going to have to keep moving. Right. And we're going to just quickly try and follow them. Now, she seems to move them quite often, especially when the kill is finished. And Cheryl, a very good question from you, and good morning to you. We're wondering how long or at what age will the cubs be when Karula takes them out on their first hunt? I suspect not too long from now. I reckon in the next 2 or 3 months, once they get to about a year, I think she's going to start taking them out, which is quite exciting. But perhaps they'll just watch. Just going to try. I want to try and get ahead of them now, just because otherwise we're going to end up starting and stopping, and we're not going to be able to keep up with them. So we'll try and anticipate their behavior so we can carry on. Now, let's see where they're going to pop out. Are you going to come this side of the tree, or are you going to go the other side? Let's have a look. You can see that they're going to go the other side, so I'm going to go a little bit further forward so we can get them coming towards us. Here we go, this should be nice. Oh, you can hear my lovely brakes, which doesn't seem to bother them too much. So we're off-road now. So it obviously makes it quite difficult to keep the camera very steady. Here comes Madame Shongile. What a beautiful leopardess she is. I can definitely see her face is completely different from Hosanna. She's very slight. She's not very big. She's little like her mom. Well, they're actually walking right in front of the vehicle. I just wanted to duck down so you get a good view. How amazing is this to have 3 leopards pass by me in within just meters? Isn't this amazing? And she'll still prefer to move her cubs during strange hours of the day, especially with the last few scares that she's had. Instead of moving them at night when everyone else is around and the predators are all out, she's going to keep them moving during the day. Now she's having a little smell under this fallen shrub. Perhaps there was something like a scrub here, perhaps a tortoise that was in the area. We're going to have to keep moving now. This is going to be tricky. She looks like she wants to go into the drainage. So I'm going to very quickly try and just zip around and get around her and find another gap in. It's cool. It won't be but a moment. Karula, don't go racing away from us. It's so beautiful to see you. And I've just got to see your lovely daughter. I want to have a good look at her so I don't ever mistaken her for Hosanna again. Whee! Ah, and thank you so much for confirming that Tingana is indeed the king. That's great to know. I thought he was. I think Mvula has lost his title. Oh, goodness gracious. I'm going to try and find a little gap here. They're playing in the... Oh, can you see that? I think Mom wanted to have a scratch and scratch her nails, and she was bombarded by the little ones. They sort of said, no, not today, Mom. Unfortunately, you have to get your nails done at some other time. Off they go again. They're moving straight down into the drainage. So we're going to try and stick with them as best we can. Little ones. Hopefully we'll be able to find a little spot to cross. I'm going to itch forward again. Oh, what are you going to do? No, now you're crossing the complete camp. I'm trying to work out what she's doing. It looked like she was wanting to go straight down and below us, but it seems as though she's changed her pathway. And this is what happens, is this is why it is so difficult for us to try and keep up with the various cats, is because they don't always stay on the roads. Let me go back a little bit more. She's walking right on the edge of a drainage line, and there's lots of bush willows and lots of terminalias and all sorts of goodies growing around here. So we need to find a clean way in. Alright, so we're gonna just try and meander through all these trees here, and perhaps we'll find another little gap to take us down. Also just trying to keep an eye on her in case she does cross the drainage. We don't want it to let her get too far ahead of me. So it may seem like I'm going fast. I'm really not. I'm going terribly slowly. Squeaky brakes. Right, let's see where she's going to pop out. Can you see her, Brian? I'm just having a look. I've also lost sight of her. I wonder if she didn't go down into the drainage. Are we just having a little look? Trying to figure out where exactly she's gone. Okay, let me go into this thicket slightly. Poke our nose in. It's very, very dense here. Not with big, massive trees, but lots of clumps of lots of little trees, which is going to make it hard for us. Leopards are obviously lovely, streamlined creatures, and they can... Are they gone? Ah, okay. Right, I want to very quickly... I've got her again. She's going on a beautiful log, so I'm going to drive over a few of these smaller trees. Don't worry, little ones. But they're crossing. How cool is this? This is going to be fantastic. Look at them on this log. Sorry, I'm very much parked at a strange angle. There, they jumped across. How beautiful was that? And what a way to cross. Now, I don't think we can go along that tree to cross, but I did see another spot where we could cross, but we've got to go a little bit of a way away. Look at them, very, very gracefully going over this big, this dead tree that's probably been dead for a very long time. This is so beautiful to catch them crossing a log like this. I don't think I've ever seen a leopard do this before. We often see many, many trees. Shongile was at Hosan and not taking too many chances. You see those lovely red flowers as they crossed through as well. It was quite pretty from a little dwarf wood bean that's growing. Now, I need to try and get to the other side. So while I do this, I need to reverse again. Oh, coming back. Hang on, he's coming back. He can come back out. Not going to, Mom. Hosan is quite brave. Right, Mom's, I think, deciding what she's going to do next. I need to desperately get onto the other side. So while I head across to the other side, let's go back to James for a little update.
Right, we're on the southern boundary, everybody. And good news is that Tingana has been found on a warthog kill on Arethusa. Now, we don't really have time to go off there and get into the sighting, but it's good prospects for the afternoon. Except, unfortunately, I don't think you're with us this afternoon. Anyway, it will be good prospects for our rehearsal. Now, there's a giraffe just to the left here. There we are, a quite inquisitive female giraffe. And look at her cheek pouches, full of grass. Not grass. It's not grass at all, is it, David?
No,
James. No, they have long necks because they eat leaves from trees. Now, this is my favorite trick, and many of you have seen it. No, don't go away. Don't go away. Wait. She's going to swallow, and then she's going to show you how she vomits up into her mouth. But she's not going to do that now. She thinks it's distasteful to do it in public. Oh, what a pity. It's quite amusing to watch, because you can see the bolus coming up all the way up the esophagus and into the mouth. Anyway, that was the giraffe sighting. We'll try and find one or two more of them. Good morning. How are you? Good. Full of joy. Thank you very much. Yes. Hello, everybody. It was very nice, thank you. Yes? Please squeeze away. I did, yes, thank you. That's Ryan from Arethusa, and he's just telling us about Tingana at Red Dam. He's also in a hurry to get his breakfast, so he's gone past us. Now, what new road were you talking about, David?
Oh, it's just runs parallel with this.
You mean on the fire break there?
Yes.
How does one get to it?
Probably find a gap.
Okay. I'm sure we can find a gap, yes. We'll find a gap and go on to the fire break. I think it'll be more pleasant than this very large main road. Here's a gap, David. I found one. Here we go, everybody. I hope you're as excited as I am. Hello, Tanner. You have asked a question that is very relevant to what we do here. You say, how many game reserves are there in the area and are they all connected? And that's a very good question because we keep talking about Juma and Arethusa and Cheetah Plains and the Sabi Sand and the Kruger Park and the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park. And the great, well, the answer to you is, Tanner, it's all connected. It's 8.5 million acres or 3.5 million hectares of contiguous area. And the area we're on now is part of a collection of private reserves called the Sabi Sand. So they're private farms that there are various complicated legal traversing agreements between the owners. So we only drive on Juma Reserve to the west of us called Arethusa and then off to the east on Cheetah Plains. But there are no fences between us or any of the properties around us. If you really wanted to be technical about it, you'd say that we were part of the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park. That includes the Limpopo National Park of Mozambique, the Gonarezou National Park of Zimbabwe, the Kruger National Park of South Africa, and a whole lot of private reserves on the western fringes of the Kruger, like the Sabi Sand and the Timbavati up in the north. And that's how you would kind of describe it. And they're all connected, absolutely. I think let's go up this road. Thank you for that, Tanner. And the reason I've chosen this road is because this is not too far from where the lions were yesterday. And I wonder if they didn't maybe head back towards where their kill was. This seems to be the one road that Taylor did not drive this morning. There are no fresh vehicle tracks, many impala tracks going hither and yon. And the temperature is definitely increasing quite nicely now. I think we'll probably have quite a pleasant afternoon out here. Can you just confirm, Rebecca, that we do not have an open rehearsal tonight? Is that correct? Are you sure? It's apparently a public rehearsal this evening, everyone, so we are with you this evening. But we are going to double check that, just for in case, because we had a bit of a mess last time round. Ooh, there's a sunbird here. Now, David, finding a sunbird is a little bit like finding a very fast-moving fly. There's a squirrel as well. You see a wet squirrel there? So the rehearsal this afternoon, everybody, is public, so you can come with us and hopefully we'll show you Tingana a bit later on. There it goes, it's gone down. I can hear the sunbird, but I can't, there it is. David, on the far left-hand side of this scraggly knobthorn tree, there is a white-bellied sunbird. No, this one here, this very scraggly thing in front of us. That's it, you got it. No, we don't often see that, everyone. And I know the light's not great because I've put it behind the bright sky. But there you can see the colours, and that's a male setting up his territory. Isn't that cool? Now, his colours are purple, he's got a bit of green, a bit of yellow. He's still there. No, he's flown off. Anyway, that is the white-bellied sunbird. Not a bird that we see on camera very often. We hear them all over the place during the summer months. Alrighty, while we have one last squiz around here for the lions, let's head to Taylor, find out where those leopards have gone and if she's left them.
The leopards have gone, I'm afraid. We tried to make our way through the drainage line and it was just too thick and impenetrable, for, unfortunately, for us to venture through there. So we have lost sight of Karula and her cubs. But at least they gave us a great few moments this morning. Perhaps they're going to pop out. They went straight into the drainage line. But don't fear, because I see something else up ahead. Is that a buffalo? I think I see a buffalo in the far distance. Well, it's not too far away. We're almost there.
And I'm hoping that Karula, if she does continue along that drainage, there's a possibility that she's going to pop out to the area that we're going. So we'll hang around and we'll have a look. Otherwise, it'll be something quite exciting to follow up on again this afternoon. Perhaps she goes out and she makes another kill. Wouldn't it be that fantastic? And I wouldn't be too surprised if she does do something like this and take advantage of the cooler weather. But the clouds have completely lifted now. I don't think we're going to get any more rain. It's actually warmed up quite nicely. There's a little bit of a breeze. It's beautiful. It's actually a very pleasant morning. I didn't mind the little drops that we got earlier. Now, Buffalo, where did you go? How did you just disappear like magic? It was like, oh no, here they are. That's not magic. Just my eyes are not working very well. Oh, and I know there's been a lot of chatter about the cuckoos. I very briefly saw a black cuckoo this morning. So I'm looking forward to hearing all the different calls. I also heard a Deirdre's cuckoo earlier. That's probably my favorite, the prettiest of the lot. But it was very nice to very briefly see that black cuckoo. Hopefully we'll be able to get a few more of them. Now there's a few buffaloes. Doesn't seem like a particularly big herd. I can just actually see the two of them. Where's the rest of your friends? This very daring, wandering about on the drainage lines, all on your own. Maybe they have got separated. Well, maybe we'll see then Kahuma is eating one of them a little bit later. That'd be nice. And off they're going into the drainage. Can you see the bateleurs up there? Sorry, I'm going to take your attention away quickly because the bateleurs are actually making an interesting noise. And then we're going to have a look. You can see them flying in the sky. And it's quite funny when they call, they sort of drop their legs a little bit, but we'll see. So it looks like that could be that one. That is an adult. Is that the adult? There's one is an adult and the other one looks a little bit like a juvenile. Beautiful. But the two of them are soaring. I see there's the adult on the left and the juvenile is the one on the right. It doesn't look like it's got its complete adult plumage just yet. We can take them a number of years. But isn't that lovely? The turkey of the sky, they make a strange noise. But let's go back over to James, who's got my favorite animal.
We've got elephants here, everybody, just quite close to us, so I'm going to be fairly quiet. A small breeding herd. Well, in fact, it's quite an extensive one. They're both sides of the road. And we had a cow just feeding quietly there until this one came up. And then they started communicating with each other, rumbling away. And I'm not sure, maybe they're just not great friends. Hello, Christine. You were chatting about the temperature here and wondering if the elephants prefer the cold weather. I don't think they prefer the cold weather necessarily, but remember, an elephant gets hotter more slowly and therefore colder more slowly than any other animal. So they can cope with a fairly large amount of heat and a fairly large amount of coolth or cold without it having a huge effect on them. There is a very large cow behind this one coming through. There she is. This is actually quite a big herd that we are semi-surrounded by now. Oh, and they smell so lovely. I don't know if you've ever smelt horses. I love the smell of horses, but it's like that kind of horsey smell, but just a bit stronger. And I suppose you might describe as slightly sweeter as well. And that is the smell of elephants. Not a small cow, that. This is wonderful, it really is. That's where we found the first cow. She was eating that Sisyphus bush. Sisyphus is also called buffalo thorn, of course, which many of you will know. It's good protein. Many nasty thorns, though, which the elephants don't seem to mind in the slightest. They're talking to each other now. I don't know if you can hear. That's the hornbills you can probably hear. But the elephants are going... David, if you look to your left, you will find that there's a small elephant hiding behind a rootstock, not more than 3 meters from where you're sitting. Isn't that cool? All right, let's quickly nip across to Taylor. She's got a primate other than Brian to show you.
We've got a very fluffy vervet monkey. There's actually an entire troop of them here, more than two, which is what we seem to see, well, what I've seemed to see seen since I've been here. There's about five or six of them, and those buffalo that we saw as well have come down into the drainage, so there's lots of action happening here. And I think the monkeys are quite happy that there's a bit of sun coming out so that they can dry themselves off after the cold rain. Up it goes, up a little tree. Are you looking for something to eat? Oh, I can hear lots of animals. I can even hear elephants in the distance. Isn't this little monkey wonderful? Well, I hope you had a wonderful morning with myself and Brian. It's been a fantastic day. A bit wet in the beginning, but it turned out to be wonderful. It ended with all the spots and a fluffy vervet monkey. So we'll see you this afternoon. So from myself and Brian, let's go back to James, though, and he's going to end it with you. No.
And there they are. Same elephants. We're just going to sit here for the next 3 minutes. That'll be the end of our drive. I think turned out pretty well, all things considered. Buffalo and elephant and leopard and tent sections and Steph on camera. Marvelous stuff. Some map drawing we had. Some microscope. And there'll be more of that this afternoon, of course, during our rehearsal for TV. Just a quick, perhaps, update for those who are new viewers. We do TV specials every so often. This is leading up to an 8-week special in January. And in order to get things sort of smooth enough for the TV and to make them snappy for a 2-hour show, that's what we're practicing. So it's just 2 hours this afternoon. And it is a bit of a rehearsal. So some of the things are quite interesting and we take a few chances with this and that. We'll just see what happens. But having you along for the ride is always great because to have an audience is much better than not having an audience. And especially those of you who are particularly patient with us and have been with us for a long time, it's great to have you along and for you to be part of our rehearsal and our evolution at Wild Earth. There's hornbills having a very severe territorial spat, singing at each other. There's a young cow there. Much younger than that big cow who walked across, I'd say was probably about 40. I'd say this cow no more than sort of 17 or so. And she's already had at least one calf. I can see that because she's lactating. They're all watching us carefully, but they're not in the least bit kind of worried about us. If I was to start the vehicle and drive, then they might. Yeah, you can see she's lactating just from the moisture there. I'm not sure which her calf is, but an elephant can have a calf very young, you know. Sometimes as young as 10 or 11 years old. And they're tiny. Well, they're not tiny, but they really are not big yet. Right, everybody, that is going to be it from us today. From the elephants here, we will say a fond goodbye. And indeed from David, who's on camera, thank you for your efforts, David. Big thank you to all of you for putting up with our technical glitches today, and I hope you enjoyed our little tent show. And also to Taylor for holding the fort in the bush, in the rain, with Brian. We'll see you later at 3:30 this afternoon, everybody. Bye-bye.